Hello and welcome to another episode of Video Game Logic. Today's show was recorded on November 22nd, 2016. I'm your host, Gaming Psychologist, and with me as always, the Alpha and the Omega.
Caffeine Rage, and I'm not sure if I like this.
On today's show, we will of course be discussing the games that we played this week. The Golden Joystick winners were announced, and we're about to tear them apart.
What?
Ubisoft does something that seems like a good idea for once. We'll have our weekly community corner and a special edition of the Steam Deals recommendations because of the fall sale. Rage, oh, and timestamps will, of course, be in the show notes following their respective topics. Now, Rage.
Nearly messed up.
How are
nearly.
You?
So close.
Nearly. I saved it. And I could edit it out and no one would be the wiser, but I won't. So.
Because that would require effort.
It would. So how are you this week, Rage?
I'm doing all right. It's been kind of a little bit of a boring week. Really plodding along on everything. But honestly, boring weeks are fine by me because, you know, usually when something interesting happens, it's bad.
Yeah, I love when I get those boring weeks every once in a while. This week has been a little bit weird just because with Thanksgiving coming up, I had to cram a bunch of clients into today and
oh my,
quite a few canceled because of the holiday. And so my today was a little weird for me. Tomorrow's a little weird for me. And then yesterday also was weird for me.
It's all right. It's weird for me when you're around as well.
Fair play. Delicious water. I've got a lot of water over here tonight. There might be multiple bathroom breaks.
Oh boy.
Oh,
I hope you went before we started.
I did. I always do. That means I'll make it like an hour and a half, maybe.
A bladder the size of a pea.
I drink a lot of water. Gotta stay hydrated. So, right off the top this week, I'm going to get this out of the way first.
Yeah, it looks like the cheeky little monkeys are going to be upset.
Are they?
If you're announcing what I think you're going to announce.
I wasn't going to do that, but I can announce that also right after this. Uh-huh. I just wanted to say really quickly, last week I made that joke about, and Kyle's about to, I don't know if he'll be mad or not, but I made that joke last week about Kyle sending in death threats. And he messaged me after he listened to the podcast, and he wasn't really upset. He just was like, hey man, I just want to let you know I would never do that. And I was like, oh, did this joke go a little too far? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, okay, I'm sorry, dude, I'll make an apology on the show. And he's like, no, you don't have to do that. And I was like, no, I should. I want our community to know that we respect them. So I do apologize, Kyle, for taking that joke a little too far. I also apologize if this is like embarrassing or weird or you didn't actually want me to do it. But tough. I'm the show host. I get to do this. The second thing that I'm going to announce that's going to make you also sad, and you too, Chemists, is that we are now officially on Podbean. All of the details will come at the end of the show whenever we, and I probably should put those in the show notes actually, whenever we do
you put them in the show notes.
Well, I'll put them there where that you can put them where you want them to. But
because I've seen what happens when you touch the show notes.
Fair play. But we signed up for a year of Podbean hosting thanks to the support of our generous patrons who take care of us. But that does mean that we're going to be moving off of our RSS feed onto a new RSS feed. I've still got to get that part specifically sorted out properly.
Does this mean I'm going to have to learn another website?
Yeah.
Ah, fuck.
But we'll be dropping one of them.
Well, on the plus side, hopefully it has a better URL.
Which URL are you currently talking about?
Videogamelogicpodcast.blogspot.com.
Oh, no. This is, I believe it's vglpodcast.podbean.com. So it's not that much better.
Well, on the plus side, yeah, it's not breaking the VGL podcast on everything else.
No, that is very true. I'll look into that stuff later. Maybe when we take a break, I'll get it put in. That way we can plug it properly at the end. But for the next couple of weeks, while I'm getting things sorted out and the kinks worked out, we're going to double post, which more work, a little bit more work, but just to make the transition smooth and just in case I screw up the first upload or something like that. So for the next week or two, we'll do double posting. But after that, we'll make a final announcement and say, okay, this is the last episode that's going to be at our old RSS. Everybody move over to the new one. Like, you have to move over to the new one if you want to keep listening. So.
Yeah, and also you should probably put a small audio file at the end of the old RSS.
Yeah, I can do that. That'll be pretty, or that'll be very easy to do.
Just a couple minutes saying we are moving to a new RSS and give a link.
Yeah, I can do that. That'll be really easy. So we did it, guys. We got it all sorted out. I got everything worked out with PayPal. I found a service that offered unlimited monthly uploads at a fair price.
Yeah, because it turns out that we're kind of hard to fit into most payment schedules.
Yeah, that was the hardest thing. Like, everybody was like, yeah, with your podcast and your budget, you can just use this service. And then that service is like, yeah, there is a $5 plan, but it's like you can only upload this many gigabytes or this many hours per month. Or not megabytes, sorry.
We
If it was
could
gigabytes, you'd be okay.
maybe put one episode up on up with
Yes.
that.
Yeah. But
Because I was looking at some of them, and yeah, some of them we would max out after one episode.
But Podbean has a plan where that if you pay for the whole year up front, it works out to a little over $9 a month. And they have unlimited uploads and unlimited bandwidth, which is another thing that we run into issues with because our podcast is so long, even with our, I hate to say limited because like to us, you guys are like a huge audience, but in the grand scheme of things, our limited audience, even just because of the size of our podcast, we use a lot of bandwidth from hosting services.
Boy, we're
So,
going to make them regret this, aren't they?
maybe. But Podbean's got a lot of neat tools that I gotta just figure out how to use.
Maybe there's some nice promotional tools in there. I haven't looked at Podbean stuff at all.
There are some promotional tools. We can also monetize the podcast through Podbean if we ever choose to go that way. We can have
Yeah, that's something
premium.
that we're going to have to figure out at some point.
We can have premium subscribers, which I don't think that we're ever gonna do.
Yeah,
That's
I don't
not in
like premium.
our, yeah, but I mean there's lots of little tools and all kinds of things that
Yeah,
I
in other
haven't
words, we're
spent a
going to have
cent
a
yet.
nice little talk at some point in the not too distant future about this.
Yeah, I've been struggling to import the RSS because our episodes are abnormally large. And so like it would import a few episodes and then it'd be like the import process has failed. So I had to run the import
And
tool.
then just start crying in the corner. Why are you doing this to me?
I had to run it like 10 or 12 times and it's still kicking back errors on certain episodes. And I just was like, you know what? I'll deal with this later.
Could always just do a manual upload.
I could. I'm gonna have to do that anyways for some of the episodes that had fallen off of the RSS just because it had been going for so long.
Yeah, the podcast is quickly approaching a year old.
Indeed it is. But enough about that. Enough about Podbean. We'll plug it later, and as we discover more things, I'm sure we'll talk about it a few more times. But yep, we're official. I think what we should do is take the next month or two's Patreon monies and give that to Internet Archive.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like a bad idea. Give them a little bit of cash for putting up with us.
Yeah, and I mean, technically, our content will still be hosted there, I assume forever, unless the site,
Yeah, the site doesn't do a deletion on it, as far as I can tell, so it'll still be there. And there's also other archives. We have both copies of the podcast on our YouTube channels. So that's serves as a secondary archive. So even if the RSS feed goes down when the podcast ends, because it's not something that you like thinking about, but it's something that you have to admit that the podcast isn't going to last forever.
Nope. We'll go for as long as we can, but eventually all good things must come to an
Or we just die.
end. That still means it comes to an end.
Because that's probably about the only way I would stop doing this, because I've been a pain in the ass doing episodes.
I couldn't imagine podcasting with anyone else, buddy.
Oh, until you replace me with Kyle.
Nah, maybe. Depends on how much I have to apologize for.
Oh, well, we have plenty to apologize for already.
Yeah, good point. All right, you ready to go talk about some games? This is going to be a huge game-heavy episode.
Yeah, lots of games to talk about this week, just in general, with all our topics and what we're planning for the weekly picks. So, if you don't like video games, why the fuck are you listening to this?
That's a fair point. If you don't like video games, why are you listening to us in the first place? I mean, I'll happily accept the numbers, but
Yeah, true.
you know.
It's very weird. If someone absolutely hates video games and is listening to this, there's some ulterior motive going on that I'm not sure if I like.
Yeah, maybe. We'll see.
Jared wakes up in somebody's basement.
Wouldn't be the first time.
And
I'd
you'll be
remember.
like, I'm okay with this.
Depends on how nice the basement is. Had to remember to start my music. I don't think it's, I mean, we talk about it that at least you listen to music. I also listen to music when we record sometimes, but I always pause it for the intro. I struggle enough to get through it despite having done it like, I don't know, 50 for nearly 50 episodes at this point. I still struggle to get through it sometimes.
Well,
Music
the
just
thing
makes
is
it
that it
worse.
changes so much.
That's true. It does change every week.
Yeah, and if you're wondering, I'm listening to some Chopin right now because I am civilized as fuck when I'm recording.
I'm listening to a classic rock playlist on Google Play. Currently, I'm listening to Rockaway Beach from the Ramones. Good song. Anyways, let us move into our games, Rage, as we do. We'll get back to normal this week, and I'll let you go first.
Yeah, back to abnormal with what I did for the Sunday sampler this week, The Book of Demons, a card-based sort of ARPG, or at least it wants to be an ARPG. That's my problem with this game, is that it tried to boil down the ARP genre to its core, and I think it boiled it down so much that it burned it.
Okay.
My main problem with it is that it feels so much like a mobile game. And that's actually my problem with both the games I'm going to be talking about this week, but the other one far more so. Let's put it this way. Movement in this game, well, it's your typical ARPG. You're going into a dungeon, going down the levels to kill the big bad boss at the end. I absolutely love the art style of this game. It's all paper craft and all the movement, sort of South Park style, where instead of animation, they're kind of just jutting along.
Right.
And the gameplay isn't bad, except for one key thing that kind of bugs me. Well, actually, two key things that bugs me. One, the movement. If you go on the Steam store page and you look at the at one of the screenshots that shows the actual dungeon, you'll notice a path. You see that?
Path. Yeah,
Okay.
actually, yeah, that
Your
little stone path.
hero can only move along that path, and that makes dodging incoming damage nearly fucking impossible, making it so that you have to rely on a more tanky build. And honestly, that kind of takes away a bit of ARPG strategy because some builds and some characters are more based around ducking in, doing a lot of damage quickly, and then ducking out, avoiding a lot of damage. And that's what I mean by they tried to boil down the ARPG genre and just missed the mark. And also the other thing is that it plays more like a cookie clicker than an ARPG game. Yes, I realize ARPGs have a lot of clicking in them. But in the early access build that I played, you only have the warrior as a playable character. But anything that you could see on the screen, you're able to click and do damage to, which felt more like a ranger character or a mage character. The only real difference between the characters is the available cards that you get, which makes it feel, like the character classes don't matter all that much. It's something that bugged me playing, and it's one of those games that I don't think it's for me. Someone that likes these kind of things would enjoy this game, but I didn't.
Yeah.
There were things I really liked. There was a something that they called the Flexoscope, which is basically changing the length of the levels to make it so that you can play a shorter game if you really want to. But anytime that you play a game, you're progressing the main story, or you're progressing further down the dungeon, and there's no going back. If you hit a brick wall, you're fucked. So that's something that kind of bugged me as well.
That's interesting. I do like the option, though. I like the option.
But it felt more like an option for a mobile game than a PC game, to be perfectly honest. Because once you get to the end of the level, you could still, back out and go to town. It just doesn't make all that much sense to me. I like the option. It's just, it's something that makes it feel more like a mobile game. And like I said, just how the combat works in general, where instead of combat being focused around your character and, casting spells out, it's all, just clicking what's on screen, and it doesn't really matter if you really have line of sight on something or not.
Right.
So it's that weird disconnect, and making it feel more like they were trying to be an ARPG with card elements, but never really figured out what an ARPG is about. The card element is interesting, though. There is a very limited number of cards in the early access build that I played, but they are promising to have more by the time the game releases either next month or in early 2017. And some of the cards do greatly change your playstyle, or makes it so that you could be a lot tankier, which you really, really need. But I'm a little concerned that, the randomness of the cards, because that's how you attack is your cards, or you have the auto attack, which is just click and hold on something. It could be a little bit detrimental, because, if you don't get a good card, or you don't get that heal card that you desperately need, you may be in a lot of trouble.
Right. Sounds interesting.
Yeah, it's interesting, but at the same time, I have issues with it. Let's see, other things that they have, this cauldron that, as you go down the dungeon, you get ingredients that goes into the cauldron and essentially makes like a upgrade and item soup that you occasionally go collect. You could see what I'm talking about on one of the screenshots. And every time you collect those prizes, the price goes up to collect the next set. But if you die, all those prizes go away. So, it's sort of a risk-reward thing, which I kind of like, but at the same time, I don't like that it's constantly increasing. Granted, it does start very cheap, so, it's one of those things that you have to be fairly good at the game to be able to go long enough to get a good set of prizes without, just causing that cauldron to be completely inaccessible because you hit it too many times.
Right.
And let's see. And also the cards have a mana cost to them, as you may expect with the equipment cards. You can see on one of the screenshots, it actually eats up your mana pool. So as you build up your mana, you have to build it up further than what you normally would especially for a warrior or a ranger class. Because all the equipment that you equip cuts into that pool. So it's something that you have to balance out fairly carefully. And if you're not careful, you're going to end up with, not be able to equip the cards that you need to be able to survive. And I'm afraid also that you're going to end up brick walling as you just continue further down to the dungeon. So, a few concerns about the game overall.
Right.
But the thing is that it does have a free demo that you could try, which has a fair chunk of the game, I believe, down to the first boss. So, it is something that you can try out.
Yeah, I would.
Looks very pretty. It is a very beautiful art style on it.
It does look good.
But looks... it's also so busy with what it's doing, because you have to click all the characters to do damage. There's only a handful of AoE abilities that I ran into. You are stuck on this track that it just makes no sense, because if something's sitting at the end of the track and shooting arrows at you, there is no way for you to dodge at all. And that just drives me absolutely batty.
Right.
If you get stunned, do you have to... everything kind of slows down. You have to click stars. So that's why I said that it feels so much like a mobile game. Different characters have different things that you have to do to them, like the Red Heart characters, you know, simple kill. But anything that has a shield, you have to click the shield icon and hold on that, unless you have an ability that breaks the shield down immediately. And, you know, those icons can be very lost very easily in the just the gigantic mess that could happen in a very, very big battle. Casters also have icons that you have to click and hold to basically counteract their spells. And while they're casting, they can't take damage, so you have to interrupt them. And letting casters just have free reign could be very detrimental, because they could summon, they could just port around and cause you all sorts of trouble. It's just, like I said, it's graphically very pretty, but it gets very, very busy very quickly.
Right. I'd like I try said, it.
Not for me, but, you know, if someone wants something different for an ARPG or is kind of interested in the ARP genre, but likes more mobile style games or more, I hate calling this mobile style, but it's the best way I could think of to describe it, just how it handles. Because there's only limited hotkeys with the abilities. But even then, the abilities, you can be cursed, which will offset your card, and you have to click on it to fix it. And you can't do that with the hotkey, so you have to click on the cards occasionally anyway. So yeah, that's why I said it feels so mobile-ish.
Right. Yeah, it seems interesting. I'd like to give it a shot. I don't know how much I'd like it. It's got a couple things in it that I'm like, well, I usually don't like this, but
yeah,
it does have a nice art style, and
it's
looks...
also isometric, which I know you don't like.
Yeah, but it does have a nice art style, and it looks,
it's interesting.
Yeah, it looks interesting. It looks a little different.
Mm-hmm. I like that they're trying things different, but the thing is that it just doesn't feel like it plays all that well. And this is also the first of 7 planned games from this company that they're planning on shaking up different genres. And they're going to be all interconnected. And the opening screen makes that very clear that they're planning on this. That they're going to be connected in some way.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's going to be it's interesting to see where they're going to go with this and what else this company is going to do. Because, yeah, if they could do a more simplified RPG, for example, or a more simplified action game that they're not boiling down too far, then it'll be interesting. And I hate using the word interesting so often, and it makes it sound like a negative term when I say it like this. But it's, yeah, it's one of those things that I can't really praise it, but I can't really condemn it, because, you know, I don't personally like what they did with some of the things, but also some of the things kind of work as well.
Right. Interesting. Okay. What is your other game?
My
yes,
other
I
game.
I said interesting.
Yeah. My other game is a very mobile-esque, they call it a brain training game, but I'm going to respectfully disagree with them. It's a math game. You play essentially a caretaker of this little girl named Chili, and you're trying to find her mother in China through a road trip. And how it plays out is that you watch a cutscene, and during the cutscene, you have to watch very carefully, because there's all these numbers that will pop up, and you have to click the numbers to essentially collect them.
Okay.
And once the cutscene plays out, you have a number that it's given to you, and the numbers that you collected, you have to try to make that number. So you may have 1/2. So it divides, you know, your current number by half, or, you know, maybe times something or plus something. And you're just trying to make that number, and that's the game.
And, so it's like a math puzzle game.
Yeah, sort of. But here's my problems with it. One, they need to fucking learn how to port to PC, because if I have to go into the Windows Mixer to change your volume, you're doing something wrong.
Yeah, that's not good.
And also, another strike against it is the numbers are semi-randomized. And it's requiring you to hit both arrow keys and click the numbers at the same time. So, you have to be either juggling back and forth, or, you know, one hand on the keyboard, one hand on the mouse, trying to desperately click around while you're trying to do a arrow key sequence. And yes, it is arrow keys, by the way. Which I can't even think of a game that's used arrow keys in quite a while. Maybe Sleeping Dogs for the cell phone, but that's actually a fairly old game now.
Yeah, the only games I can think of that do it are pretty old. Well,
That you have to do at rapid fire while having to click on little numbers that may or may not be in that cutscene. And also, something else that really pissed me off was the question mark arrow keys. They'll give you a sequence that you have to memorize, and then you have to type in the sequence. And the sequence was between 7 and 10 arrows long. And you have a time limit of probably about 10 seconds. And every time you get one wrong, it cuts down the time.
Okay.
Yeah. So maybe that's how they're trying to get the brain training in, you know, and make you have a fucking aneurysm.
Maybe so. That does not sound great, though, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a reason why I didn't play this game that much, but I absolutely, once again, fell in love with the art style because it does have a very good art style. It has this, sort of this cel-shaded hand-drawn thing going on.
Yeah, I really like the art style. I'm looking at it on the Steam page.
Yeah, and that's why I originally started trying it out for the Sunday sampler, was that I wanted to do a video on it, but it just pissed me off so much.
Yeah. It's really interesting. This is a very unclean or not neat art style. Like, yeah. It looks very messy, but in a good way. Mm-hmm. Kind of like...
It looks almost watercolorish some of the things, like the wash tub that you see on one of the screenshots. It looks like someone took watercolor and colored it in.
Yeah, it looks really nice. I like it. I absolutely love the art style,
but oh, yeah,
not it just great.
Was one of those things that it's a game that I think would make a really good. Game the movie, you know, like on YouTube, you know, cut out all the gameplay elements and just have all the cutscenes together.
Right.
Because it had something going on with trying to find her mother. But the thing is that it was just so infuriating to try to play it. And like I said, maybe the brain training is trying to just prevent you from having an aneurysm. And you can see on one of the screenshots what I was talking about, where the goal is 189 times 2. And you have those numbers. And you could also swap them out with other numbers that you collected in the previous cutscene.
Yeah.
That's what I was trying to talk about. So, yeah, that's where it gets a little... frustrating. And also you have in the screenshots case, you have 45 actions to get to it, which may seem like a lot, but depending on the numbers that you get, it can be a little tight.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. And really disappointing because I wanted to like this a lot more, but it just feels once again like a mobile port, but in a very bad way in this case.
If it releases and it's cheap enough, I might actually pick it up. Like,
it's supposed to be pretty cheap if I recall correctly.
Like, I'd pay like $5 for this and spend a couple hours beating it to experience the story and
just have a fucking aneurysm whenever it says, okay, here's 12 question marks that you have to remember the arrow keys for, and here's 10 seconds. Go.
Yeah, that might be frustrating, but I mean, if the story's good enough, I think it'd be worth it for me.
Gotta get cheaper. The thing is, I didn't even get that far into the story before I gave up on it. Because I started hitting all the question mark things. It's like, okay, yeah. You're not giving me enough time to even memorize it. I would have trouble getting the arrow sequence down without the question marks. It was that tight of a time frame.
Yeah.
But yeah, all right. That wraps up Chili.
All right. Well, that means it's my turn. First game I've got on my list is a game by the name of Zigfrak.
Zuntite.
It is a very odd name. Zigfrak is an older game. It was released originally in 2012.
Back when the dinosaurs roamed the earth.
Indeed. And it is... kind of sort of procedurally generated looter shooter in space. There are completely pre-built scripted portions of the galaxy where the main story takes place, but there are some options when you start a new game to determine things like how many factions exist in the world and how peaceful or warring everyone is and things like that. And then all of the space that's outside of kind of the story mission
The
to
space
fill in the
between
rest of the map.
spaces.
Yeah, the space between spaces is randomly generated so that you get different play experiences for when you go exploring and do side missions and stuff. The game was dead for a couple of years after it came. Like, it released, it did okay for a little while, and then it just kind of died off and the dev disappeared. And everyone thought that the game was just done, which the game itself still worked. It was still a fun game, but it did suffer from being older and being on a 32-bit engine and just the amount of crap that can happen, especially at high levels when you're playing the game and be like, you, I mean, you can be swarmed by hundreds of enemies. And, since it's a looter shooter, you're constantly like leveling up and getting better ships and equipment and stuff like that. And so, 200 ships might be all right for you to deal with, but your computer might be groaning under the weight of all of the stuff going on.
It'll be very cinematic.
It would be very cinematic. But literally, like a month ago, if that, the dev suddenly showed back up and was like, hey,
Rose from his grave.
yeah, he's like, hey, I've actually been working on this game for a long time. I rebuilt it from the ground up in 64-bit OS form. Everyone who owns the game already will get, that as part of an update. Your save files will be fine. And that's the new version of the game going forward. And he added a whole bunch of new story content,
I
scripted
didn't mention
stuff.
something about brains.
Oh. Yeah, but he added a whole bunch of new stuff to the game and revamped some of the systems, fixed some changes that people have been complaining about for a long, or, changed some things that people have been complaining about for a long time. So I spent a couple of 3 hours this week playing it, and it's still a blast. It does do some things that some of the changes are a little bit weird. Like, the game always had kind of a tongue-in-cheek humor to its scripted dialogue and the bits of it that are actually voice acted. Most of it's reading, but some of it is voice acted, and it was always a little bit tongue-in-cheek. And he did take it and kind of tip it over the edge and make it, I don't know, almost like a parody in some ways. I think he's parodying a lot of things that have happened in the last couple of years in sci-fi. There's some No Man's Sky references and
Well, Sean Murray, just exiled on a planet somewhere.
no, well, maybe, I don't know. I haven't found that, but the trainer makes a reference to Hello Games, and there's like some references to The Office in there, the Office TV show that is. And I'm like, this is weird, but okay. So it's kind of, I don't know, some people might like that. I find it a little bit too much over the top to actually be funny. It just is kind of groan worthy. But hopefully the regular tongue-in-cheek stuff still exists. I don't think he redid the entire story, so I'll get to that part eventually. But it's a fun game. The only issue that I really have with it is it doesn't have the best support for controllers or flight sticks. So it's kind of hit and miss on what works. For example, an Xbox 360 pad works, but an Xbox One pad does not.
Weird.
My Logitech joystick does not work. There are people who say that their Logitech joysticks do work, and I realize that there's different types, but in general, they use the same sort of mapping across devices.
Yeah, the fact that an Xbox One controller doesn't work while the 360 does, that those are supposed X input devices. Those should work, both of them. He must be
But
doing something really weird coding wise.
yeah, so I mean, he's been really good about the dev has been really good about being on the Steam forums, talking to people, fixing bugs. Like, for example, when I started playing the other day, there was a bug that myself and several other people were experiencing who were on Windows 10, and it only affected Windows 10 users. Go figure. But there was a bug where we got caught in a loop in the training mission, and we couldn't progress past the first 30 minutes of the game. And within like 8 hours of someone posting that the bug, like they were experiencing the bug, and a few other people going, oh yeah, I'm experiencing this too. This is how it seems to be happening. He had came in, seen what was going on, said he was going to fix it, figured out how to fix it, and pushed an update.
Sheesh.
So, dude's working hard.
Like the anti-Hello games.
Yeah. And it's not, I mean, it's still very playable with mouse and keyboard. You can do tons of stuff to set up a mouse as like a virtual joystick, and you've got the keyboard, so you've got a million and one buttons that you can set up to do anything that you could do on a joystick. But it would be nice if I could play it with a joystick. I'm going to go ask in the forums later if there's a fix for it, or if he plans on adding increased joystick or controller support. So we'll see, but I've really been enjoying it. It's, I mean, literally just looter shooter in space. It's it's Borderlands with spaceships is the best way to say it, except the loot is even more disposable. Like, you can set up rules for automatically replacing your loot just because you get so much crap. So it's a fun game, though. If you're looking for just like mindless destruction and exploration with a sci-fi twist, Zigfrak may be for you. It's definitely for me. And it's cheap, too. I mean, it's only $8, and that's full price. So it goes on sale all the time. So it's one to watch if that sounds interesting to you.
Yeah, it sounds somewhat interesting. Very interesting. We're saying interesting a lot again.
We are. I'm going to take a quick sip of water before I move on. delicious water. Okay, next on my list is Portal 2. We finished the co-op campaign.
And the DLC.
And the DLC.
Or at least the first DLC. The second one you can't technically finish.
That's true, but the second DLC is workshop content, so. I mean, I suppose you could finish it. Eventually, there will be no more maps produced for the game. Eventually,
Kyle has anything to say about it. He's already threatened to send us co-op maps.
Go right ahead. Make sure that they're...
But the thing is, we'll end up in a crate somewhere.
If audience members want to send us maps, the only requirement is that they're actually beatable. They can be difficult, but they have to be beatable. I don't want you to send us a map and be like, hee hee, you can't actually beat this map. We will find you.
Co-op would be preferred.
Yeah, co-op would be preferred. But anyways, having beaten the co-op campaign, just wanted to talk about it for a little bit. That game is awesome.
Yeah, I really like cackling like crazy at the ending cutscenes.
Yes, they were amazing. I mean, the game is great. Valve has some excellent puzzle designs that they put into that game, which is particularly for the co-op mode. I mean, it's important for single player, but I feel like it's even more important that the level designs be good for co-op. And they were
and they
great.
Also used the fact that you had two people very intelligently at some times.
Yeah, certain puzzles, the way you had to complete them. Like the one, I don't remember which level it was, but where we had to jump through a portal at the same time and crash into each other.
Yeah,
so
I was
we could
about to say
exactly
that one.
That was probably, I think, the best example, but there's lots of other examples.
Or towards the end of the DLC where we had to essentially swap places a couple times to get all our portals in position.
Yeah. And it was fun. Some of them we were definitely a challenge to figure out, but at no point did I feel like the puzzles were unfair. I just felt like we were either being too stupid or too smart for our own good.
Yeah, we were trying to overthink a few of them when it was, very simple answers.
Yeah. I am going to go back and play the single player. I mean, I really enjoyed Portal 1.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to hearing about your adventures in the single player.
I'm going to put together a list of games that I'm going to complete over Christmas because I have 10 days or 11 days off from the clinic. And I mean, family's going to be here and we're going to be doing stuff, but I definitely will get plenty of time to play games. So especially because there's going to be people here, I can play games more reliably during the day. So Portal 2 is on the list of games to complete during that time. I'm probably going to strive for two or three short to medium length games as opposed to just like one massively long one.
Yeah, Portal 2 single player, I want to say, is 6 to 8 hours.
Yeah, and I would consider that a pretty short game.
And also, I think you would be more on the short side now that you have experience with the puzzle elements.
Yeah, with all of the mechanics of the game.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to it. Great game. They'll never make a third one. Valve just can't do three. They only know how to count to two.
You know, I'd love to see them do something like the black box, and it's Left 4 Dead 3, Half-Life 3, Portal 3, Team Fortress 3.
A long time ago, when Steam boxes, like, we
Yeah,
didn't know what those
they
were.
originally had a black box.
Yeah, but there were a lot of people that said, you know what? When Steam finally releases those Steam machines, it should come with all of those things, and they would sell a billion of them.
If they made Half-Life 3 exclusive to the Steam machines, they would sell so many Steam machines just because they've had this cliffhanger for, what, the better part of a decade now?
Yeah.
And the fact that the DLCs ended in this absolutely massive cliffhanger and threatening to tie together Portal and Half-Life. A matter of fact, there's a Easter egg in Portal 2 that I want you to find. That's
Okay.
mentioned in the ending DLC, or the ending of the second DLC for Half-Life 2.
Okay.
Have you played the DLC?
I have. It's been a long time, though.
Okay. Sure, I'll tell you what it is so you can try to find it.
Yeah, you can, or I mean, I can just
Okay,
look it up online.
it is the dry dock for the Borealis. It's
Okay.
in Portal 2.
Oh, okay. Interesting. I'll have to find
So
that.
when that came out, people were like, "Oh, they're doing Half-Life 3. They're doing Half-Life 3." No, they're not doing Half-Life 3. Honestly, I would be surprised if they ever do Half-Life 3 at this point.
Yeah, I'd also be surprised.
Pleasantly surprised, I might add, but they just have so much on the line now. There is no way that Half-Life 3 could live up to the hype, and not even the hype that they generated. This isn't a No Man's Sky territory where, they generated hype for years to just epic proportions and then just shed out a game. They have actually said nothing about Half-Life 3 or have been very closed about what they were saying about Half-Life 3. And people have torn apart Half-Life 2 and its DLCs, torn apart Portal 2, trying to find these connections and trying to find where Half-Life 3 could be going.
Yeah.
Or even the Half-Life Episode 3, because originally it was going to be three episodes. And boy, Valve really missed the mark on episodic content, huh?
Yep. Still waiting for that third episode, guys. Oh. Okay. Well, are you ready to go talk about our main event, our main line?
Let's dive into this.
All right.
All right, let's change things up and talk about video games.
Yeah, let's go talk about the Golden Joystick Awards. There were, how many categories were there? 10?
I think so. Let's see. Well, there's a best original game. There is best storytelling, best visual design, best audio, best multiplayer, best indie, best moment in association with Absolute Radio, which some of these are spoilers, so I may not want to dive into those. Most wanted game in association with Green Man Gaming. Game of the Year, PlayStation Game of the Year, Nintendo Game of the Year, PC Game of the Year, and Competitive Game of the Year.
I wasn't counting like a dummy.
Well,
11,
that's why I was
12,
reading them
13.
off.
There's 13.
I was
There's
expecting you
13.
to be counting them.
13. 13, guys. 13.
And there
So,
are four lights.
yeah. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go through each of the categories like we always do. We're going to say what won it, and then we're going to discuss whether or not we agree and which game we thought should be the
Yeah,
winner.
well, we should probably also mention the nominees, which some of these categories have 17 nominees, so we're not going to
Yeah.
dive into each of them.
Yeah.
So let's just go ahead and start right down the list. Best original game. The winner was Overwatch.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I agree with this. Just the fact that original game and Overwatch is so derivative of really everything that really Team Fortress 2 put down.
Yes, but Overwatch was or is a new IP, a new sort of lore.
Let's put it this way. If this wasn't a Blizzard IP and Overwatch came out exactly the same from, let's just pick someone at random, Ubisoft. Would it have won this? Is it the fact that it is Blizzard putting out a new IP, giving it that edge?
That's tough. Because, I mean, Blizzard puts out so few IPs.
Yeah, they've been busy on the treadmill, cranking out either Hearthstone content, which was the last major IP that they've released, which was a derivative of their other IP, World of Warcraft. Was it Heroes of the Storm that was last, which was also derivative of all of their IPs?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure if Overwatch, I'm with you, I'm not sure if Overwatch is the pick, but I think you're a little more like, no, it's not. I'm a little more like, well maybe I could see it.
Well, let's look at the other nominees for this. Abzu, which I don't recognize. We're going to put a break in here.
What?
I just heard the train crossing a drop.
So, now that we're back from our little break.
Yeah, a little bit of sloppy editing and some elevator music.
Absolutely. You were going to start...
let's be honest, elevator music beats train whistle.
Most of the time, yeah. I've left the train whistle in a couple of times.
On accident, or...?
No, on purpose. Just because it flows with the edit.
Yeah, poor listeners.
Anyway, so you were reading off the list. You mentioned Abzu first.
Yeah, Abzu, which honestly I don't recognize.
Abzu is a little...
it's going to be a mobile game, isn't it?
No, it's not a mobile game. It's okay.
Now that I look at it, now I recognize it.
Yeah.
I didn't recognize it by name.
Yeah, it's made by the people who made Journey, I believe. Nah.
Yeah, let's see. Firewatch, which is a walking simulator. Fury, which is a boss battle arena. Hyperlight Drifter, which I don't recognize.
I don't recognize that one either. Do some quick Googling.
It's on Steam, at least. It looks like it's a an exploration game. That has a very nice art style.
Yeah, it's a 2D ARPG.
Let's see. There's Inside, which also I don't recognize all that well.
Looking that one up.
Yeah, this is the problem with some of these niche games. Very nice art style once again. It's hang on, who made this? Because this looks familiar.
Oh, Inside is made by the people who made Limbo.
Made Limbo. Yeah, I was about to say, wait a minute, this looks familiar now that I look at it. They had No Man's Sky.
There's actually one category on here that I'm going to defend No Man's Sky for, but...
Probably visuals.
Yeah. Yeah.
But even then, we'll get to that. Quantum Break, which is interesting. It's third person, isn't it?
It's a third person action game. Kind of a beat 'em up with some RPG elements.
Yeah, with a heavy focus on time manipulation.
Yeah.
Soma, which I always blank on this one. I know it, but...
It's a deep sea horror game, basically.
Okay. Yeah, it's one of those things that I know the game, but I always blank on it.
Yeah.
Let's see. Tom Clancy's The Division, which was how that turned out.
Yeah.
And then The Witness, which... Yeah, I hope you like line puzzles, because, boy, we have a lot of line puzzles.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is actually a tough category because there's really no clear winner.
But I think Quantum Break should have been it.
Quantum Break, but it does have its... some issues with it performance-wise. Maybe that's why I'm a little hesitant on it. Or at least on PC. And they do have a interesting thing where they're tying in webisodes almost like how Alan Wake did.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's an interesting way of doing it.
Except they're integrated. It's not an optional thing. That's one of the main reasons that I think that it makes best original game. It's trying to do something a little bit different.
Yeah.
Because they kind of have choose-your-own-adventure elements to them, and you pick different different choices give you different little webisodes and shape your story differently going forward and in a few different ways. I really like the idea of that kind of emergent narrative and looking at storytelling differently. A lot of people didn't like it, and I understand why, because if you skip them, you miss a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
and
you have no idea what the hell is going on.
But, I mean, to me, being a story guy, I think that that's great. So that's what I would say I think should have been the best original game. But I do understand that game
I think
flaws.
I would probably agree with you on that.
Wow, because
I'm looking at the others. Tom Clancy did The Division. Interesting idea, but it just didn't do well. Granted, post-launch support supposedly has improved it quite a bit.
Yeah.
The Witness, Soma, I honestly don't know enough about it. No Man's Sky. Inside feels so much like Limbo from what I've seen of it. Now that I recognize the game, because it's one of those things. But it and Soma, I'll look at the name and I'm blank on it until I look at a screenshot. Right. Hyper Light Drifter, it is a very pretty art style, but I don't know enough about it. Fury is really interesting. It's essentially arena combat bosses only. The only thing that I could think of that's even close to it would be actually... now I'm blanking on it. All the Titans PS2 game. I'm blanking on the name of it.
I know what game you're talking about, but I can't think of the name either. But it's the game where you basically go on a journey and you fight like 8 bosses or something like that. Maybe it's more than that, but it's just giant bosses.
Yeah, and I'm completely blanking on the name of it. Shadow of the Colossus.
There you go. That's it.
Yeah, Shadow of the Colossus is the only other game I could think of that's similar to Fury. So, and that's, well, I should say gameplay-wise, where you're only fighting bosses. So I'd say that would be also a strong contender. Firewatch, pretty standard walking simulator. And Abzu, so yeah, I think I would put it a toss up between Quantum Break and Fury, depending on the day of the week, you know.
Yeah, I think I'd say between Quantum Break and Firewatch, although I'm leaning more towards Quantum Break. Firewatch had some interesting psychological elements to it that really draw me in, but that's an incredibly personal thing, you know. Like, I mean, that game did appeal to other people, but I definitely would have a special affiliation with it just because of the way that they handled the potential, like, are you going crazy? You know, that sort of thing. That element of the story.
Well, the thing is also I haven't played Firewatch yet. And
yeah.
It's on my to-do list, and that's why I don't know that much about it.
That's fair, too. Honestly, you could just watch a Let's Play on YouTube and get most of it.
Yeah, well, let's speaking of story, let's move right along.
Right.
To best storytelling. The winner of this was The Witcher 3 Blood and Wine. So, not even The Witcher 3, but a DLC for Witcher 3, which I'm not sure if I agree with them giving it to a DLC, unless it's a DLC category.
Yeah.
Because this is basically rewarding The Witcher 3 twice, saying, everything else sucks so much that we have to drag a DLC into this.
Yeah.
Which, it just feels so weird to give it to a DLC. And this isn't the first time that we're going to be talking about this as well.
No.
The other nominees, or do you want to talk about this?
About what?
About the fact that they're given to DLC over a full game.
Oh, no. I was going to go talk about the other nominees, because I don't think that The Witcher 3, since it is a DLC, I don't think that it should be included, because that game came out last year.
Yeah, that's the thing. That's really how you have to try to figure this out, because... how do you define when a game releases, especially these days where you have early access? You have pre-orders that give you access early. You have heavy post-release updates. Look at The Division, for example, because supposedly The Division's last major update fixed some major issues that were had with the game.
Yeah.
But, yeah, are you considering The Division when it launched, or its current state, or what it could be? So, yeah, it's just a very weird thing there. So, the other nominees in this were Firewatch, once again, Oxenfree, Quantum Break, Rise of the Tomb Raider, Soma, Tales from the Borderlands, Uncharted 4, Thief's End, and Zero Time Dilemma, which a couple of these I don't recognize. Let's see, Zero Time Dilemma, that's a Nintendo DS game, so I would not know that one. Tales from the Borderlands, I know of, but I never really paid attention to because it's Borderlands, and I've kind of broken away from what Telltale has been doing with their games in general.
Honestly, Tales from the Borderlands is probably the best Telltale game that exists to date. I haven't played Minecraft Story Mode, which supposedly gives it a run for its money, but I've played all the rest of them, or almost all the rest of them. Tales from the Borderlands takes the Borderlands universe, which,
I
you
do
know, the
like the
best.
universe, but it's one of those things that I just kind of fell off from because it turned into such a bullet sponge.
Right. Well, what Tales from the Borderlands does is it takes all of the promise that exists in the Borderlands universe that you kind of get scraps of through the main games, and it just expands on it. There's a couple of, quick time event combat sections, but most of the game, like probably 95% of the game, just revolves around conversing with people from the entities that you know of from inside the game, like other execs and people that are in the Hyperion Corporation, or certain bandit factions that you've met in the games that you kind of link up with to for mutually beneficial reasons and things like that. So, I mean, it's the best, I think, of the Telltale games, like I said. And it might, I know that you dislike the Borderlands for the combat and stuff like that. There's almost zero of that in Tales from the Borderlands. So,
Well, I
you do
shouldn't say I
you, but.
dislike it for the combat. I disliked it for where the combat went.
Right. But it is a good one, so. Yeah, might be worth your time.
Yeah, it's just one of those things that where I think we're not really going to have a clear winner on this, just because a couple of these I have personally avoided any story notes on because I want to play them. Like Rise of the Tomb Raider, I want to play that eventually.
Yeah.
Oxenfree is on my list. Firewatch is on my list. So just from what I know. And based on just what you said with the previous one, I would lean either Firewatch or maybe Tales from the Borderlands. Even
Yeah.
though I've kind of broken away from how Telltale has went away from their point and click roots. And maybe it's just that I didn't really care for The Walking Dead. And that's, yeah. And I've not really tried to dive in again. I
Yeah.
will say that a couple of their. Things have been interesting, but it seems like Telltale is turning into a mill for licensed games, which concerns me.
They are. Although I am excited that they're doing the Guardians of the Gal or they're doing a Guardians of the Galaxy Telltale game. That information was leaked as a part of the documents that had to be revealed for the voice actors strike. So Telltale, unless something happens because of all of this, is doing a Guardians of the Galaxy game, which, in case you don't know, that is in the Marvel universe, and I
Yeah,
love
which means that
Marvel.
you absolutely love it instantly.
Yes, I love Marvel. I love Guardians of the Galaxy specifically as like a wacky. Guardians of the Galaxy is weird. It would take me too long to explain it and run on a comic book podcast, but it's weird even for Marvel. So to have a story made by Telltale, which I do really enjoy the Telltale style of game or the Telltale genre, I'm really excited. But yeah, it's kind of a toss-up for me between Firewatch and Quantum Break for reasons we already discussed, and Tales from the Borderlands just because of how good a job, in my opinion, that it does in expanding on the Borderlands universe and how much, meat is there for storytelling. I don't think The Witcher 3 Blood and Wine should be on there. That game
The
came
fact
out
that it's a
last year.
DLC, if they had a category, best DLC, I would fully support, the Witcher being in in this list. But the fact that it's here is just, it feels like an insult.
Yeah, I don't
And
know if
speaking
I
of
would.
the Witcher Blood and Wine. Guess what? One visual design.
Yeah. I don't know if that game or if that DLC here, I don't know if I go so far as to call that an insult, but I do feel like that they were probably being a little preferential because just about everybody loved The Witcher 3, and I'm sure they want to give it some more awards, so why not pick it? but I don't think it should be here.
Yeah, but one best visual design as well over Abzu, Battleborn, which poor Battleborn. I will say that Battleborn is very pretty, but it's also very, very busy.
Yeah.
Brutal, Dark Souls 3, and somewhere Kyle's squealing. Doom, Firewatch, Fury, Hyper Light Drifter, Inside, Mirror's Edge Catalyst, No Man's Sky, and that's going to be the only time I don't snicker when I mention No Man's Sky. Overwatch, Rise of the Tomb Raider, Soma, Superhot, The Witness, and Uncharted 4. Can they make the list any fucking longer?
Probably not. That's like all of the nice looking games. This one's extra tough.
Yeah, I
Extra
would
tough.
say Fury is definitely a contender just with how it looks.
Yeah.
Abzu, I just commented on how pretty it looks.
Yeah. No Man's Sky is basically a screenshot generator at this point because of
No
how
Man's Sky is
pretty that game
basically,
is.
get high as fuck and play this game.
Yeah. But I mean,
Rise of the Tomb Raider is not an ugly game.
no, but I don't think it belongs on the list.
To me, this list feels more like it's games that should be not realistic, that they're going for a particular art style.
Yeah.
And that would rule out Rise of the Tomb Raider. It partly rule out Doom, but yeah, Doom is also doing its own thing. Dark Souls 3, kinda, but it's also this really dark and gloomy thing that is completely different. It would definitely rule out Uncharted 4.
Yeah.
This is probably the only time that would really support The Witness being in contention. Superhot, it has an interesting art style, but the thing is that it's so bland. It's almost untextured. But then again, this is also visual design and not graphics. So yeah, it's a very tough call, really, overall, because
Yeah.
really, well, most of these games can make a argument, except Witcher 3 Blood and Wine, why it's here.
See, let me
I would
make sure
actually
we
think I
got.
would give it to Firewatch. It is a very nice looking game, and they do an interesting thing with its art style.
Firewatch does look interesting, but I didn't have it in mind for a pick. Let me go back and review that art style.
If I'm recalling it correctly, because there's, how all the screenshots look and
Firewatch is very pretty. It's not trying to be realistic, but at the same time,
It has a very colorful look to it.
yeah, Firewatch is very
Yeah, if I had to pick, I
relaxed.
would give Firewatch. I guess I would give Overwatch a nod here. Granted, it once again, Overwatch feels so much like a Team Fortress 3 almost,
Yeah.
except changing genres from first person shooter to almost a first person MOBA, almost but not
Yeah.
quite.
I think Overwatch has got some really interesting
Yeah,
and well-done character design,
but
but the
level design
rest,
is a little hit or miss.
yeah, the rest of the visual elements.
Abzu is definitely up the up on the list.
Yeah, Abzu's gorgeous.
Actually, I take it back. I would probably give Abzu then secondary to Firewatch, now that I really sit here and think about it. Which, yeah, I think that's how I'd do it, with Fury being third.
I think I would say, oh, this is tough. I'm actually between No Man's Sky and Mirror's Edge Catalyst for my first spot.
I
I've
just
always
refuse
loved the
to
Mirror's
acknowledge
Edge.
No Man's Sky.
That's fair. I always loved the Mirror's Edge
Yeah, it's also
art
very
style.
clean.
Yeah, and Catalyst kind of takes that and turns it up to 11. I think I would give my top pick to Mirror's Edge Catalyst, honestly, now that I'm sitting here thinking about it, talking about it. I think I would say No Man's Sky would be second, and probably third would be Abzu. Because about the only thing that No Man's Sky got right was its visual design.
Then fleecing people.
Well, yeah, but it on a positive note. Well, No Man's Sky's soundtrack is pretty good too, but there are better soundtracks. But the visual design is great. I love it, so I think those would be my top three.
Okay, so let's go to the audio side of things. The winner for this one was Fallout 4.
Which, Fallout 4 came out last year, but...
Yeah, DLC.
Yes, well, Fallout 4 also was in the past year. So, yeah, so maybe if they were going for like a fiscal thing. Year type of thing.
Yeah, I wish they would have had the limitations, say, okay, the game had to be out about this time. But the nominees were Aptitude, Doom, Hyper Light Drifter, I Am Setsuna, which I have no idea what the hell that is, Inside, No Man's Sky, Overwatch, Star Wars Battlefront, Thumper, and Uncharted 4, A Thief's End. I would say Star Wars Battlefront is a definite front runner on this. Yeah. This is one of the few things that Battlefront did well.
Yeah, whenever I looked at the list, I was like, huh, Battlefront's on there. Why didn't that win?
Yeah, really. Because that is about the only thing Battlefront did right.
Let's see. I Am Setsuna is a JRPG that is supposed to be a heavily influenced by Chrono Trigger.
Ah.
So.
Yeah, this is the first time I've ever heard of it. Oh, it's on PS4. That's what. No, it looks like it's on Steam. Well, it just, the images came up and it's like PS4 first. Interesting, but then again, this is audio design, and it's going to be very hard to really judge that, so I have to go with what I know, and what the games on here that I know is No Man's Sky, Overwatch, Battlefront, and that's it, so I have to give it to Battlefront, and I know a little bit of Doom.
It's tough. If it was best soundtrack on everything that's on here, I'd probably say No Man's Sky, but best audio seems to include the entire audio for the game. And for that, I'm between Star Wars Battlefront and Doom. I think Battlefront wins out just because of how... I mean, that game in terms of visuals and audio is Star Wars. It's not a Star Wars game. It is Star Wars.
Yeah, they did an amazing job just trying to make it look and sound like Star Wars. Unfortunately, it didn't play like a good game.
No.
It was very shallow.
It was a very mediocre game, but... I mean, Doom definitely has some really interesting qualities. The soundtrack to Doom also is amazing. So many really good heavy metal tracks. There's a lot of little things in Doom that make it go a long way too. Like this might sound a little gross, but like the sounds of bones cracking and kind of that visceral jibbing sound whenever you blow up a demon. Doom has a lot going for it, actually. I'm not talking myself out of Star Wars, but I am talking them Doom into more of a tie with Star Wars. That's tough. It's tough.
I would say what really puts Star Wars over the top is the fact that they use the movie soundtrack.
Right.
You get that Star Wars experience.
Right. Yeah, I think I'd have to give it to Star Wars, but just barely. It's like... on a scale of 1 to 10, like, Star Wars would be a 10 in that category, and Doom would be, like, a 9 or a 9.9. Like, they're really close. But I think you're right. I think Star Wars has to get it just because of it's Star Wars, man. They actually made it Star Wars.
Okay, so shall we move along to Best Multiplayer?
Yeah, let's go to Best Multiplayer. Okay, why not?
The winner was Overwatch. And the nominees were Broforce, Call of Duty, Black Ops 3, Dark Souls 3, FIFA 17, Guild Wars 2, A Heart of Thorns, Halo 5 Guardians, Keep Talking and No One Explodes, No Man's Sky, sorry, I had to throw No Man's Sky in there.
Oh, you little joker, you.
Pro Evolution Soccer 2017, Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege, Star Wars Battlefront, Street Fighter V, Tom Clancy's The Division, World of Warships, which what the fuck is that doing on here?
Yeah, that game is still in beta. Like, it's in not 0.5 something.
Yeah, and this isn't the first golden joystick that they put this in, I don't believe. And Worms WMD, which also, can you not put acronyms in? Having it PES 2017, I have to Google to see what the fuck that is.
Oh, I knew that one. I knew Pro Evolution Soccer.
Oh, once again, a tough one. Overwatch is everyone's baby right now. I would have to say that Keep Talking and No One Explodes is definitely a contender, though, just with how they'd handled multiplayer.
Yeah, the
But that's
novelty of
very,
that multiplayer
yeah, but that's a
experience.
very one-on-one experience. And I think that really hurt it overall on the judging because it's not your traditional experience. It's, one guy has the game sitting there and the other guy has a manual and flipping through it and trying to help the other guy not die.
Yeah. I don't know
And
how I
what's
feel
Star
about.
Wars doing on this list?
Yeah, that is not a very good multiplayer game. I don't know how I feel about Guild Wars. Since I mean, Heart of Thrones is an
Yeah,
expansion to
but
an
yeah.
MMO. So, but Guild Wars 2 is what, 4
Yeah,
years
that's
old or something
another
like
one is
that?
just, how do you define what gets on the list? Because if we're excluding DLCs, then we should be excluding expansions as well.
Well, I think expansions are fundamentally different than DLCs. DLCs are kind of smaller, small to medium content additions, while expansions are supposed to be very large
Yeah.
expand, I mean expansions. They add
Yeah,
huge amounts of
the
content to the
problem is that
game.
that line's been blurred hugely these days.
That's fair. That's fair.
Because if you go by that logic, then what about Blood and Wine? Because that's also supposed to be a very massive DLC.
That's fair. Blood and Wine was huge. Yeah, I think I would just say exclude Guild Wars 2. Honestly, the multiplayer in Guild Wars 2 is not that great. It has some interesting elements to it, like the combined worlds, like servers are different, like supposed to be different universes, but certain world events that would count as multiplayer take into account the progress of all servers. So those are some neat things, but that in itself, I don't think is enough to even make me really consider it. Because I mean, it is an MMO, and MMOs a lot of times don't have the best multiplayer systems, which sounds weird, but outside of like questing with your friends, a lot of MMOs fall flat in the PvP arena or.
MMOs are first a chat room,
Yeah.
second a game.
Yeah.
Do you think that's fair to say about, I want to say, 90% of MMOs?
I think that's fair because I mean, if you don't build a way for the community to interact fully enough, then your MMO dies because nobody communicates and
And then
everyone
you
just kind of goes
become
off.
Destiny.
Yeah. Yeah. Poor Destiny. I really liked Destiny.
I didn't give a shit because it's not on PC. And
That's
I'm not going
fair.
to play a shooter on console.
That's fair. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
Overwatch
this
is
is a tough
everybody's
one to
baby.
give. Dark Souls 3, it's that seamless multiplayer where somebody invades, right?
Yeah. And personally, I hate that sort of thing, but or a lot of people do like it, otherwise they wouldn't keep doing it. But
I want to almost give this to, well, excluding Overwatch, because I think that's probably the game of the year just for multiplayer because of how crazy it's been.
yeah.
If I had to give it to a nominee, I would say probably Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes, just for how novel it is.
Interesting. I think I'd say Rainbow Six Siege.
Rainbow Six Siege would be my backup.
Siege has been incredibly popular this year.
And it's gotten a lot of updates and support as well.
Yeah, it's received a ton of support. Siege is actually the rare game that here lately, its numbers have been outperforming its launch numbers, which on PC, that's a one in a million thing right there. There are very few games that can do that or
Or
even
one in
come
a Rainbow
close.
Six.
Heyo. So I think I'd have to give it a Rainbow Six Siege, honestly.
Yeah,
Outside
that's
of
my secondary
Overwatch.
choice. And then the rest of these, is really more of the same.
Yeah.
Rainbow Six Siege is doing something different with being very destructible.
Yeah. The Division, like we said before, some very interesting ideas in that game that were poorly executed.
Yeah, which has improved over time. Supposedly it's actually somewhat decent now at the high end. Everything that I've heard, the leveling experience is great. And then when you got to the end game, it
Yeah.
became a grind. You have to go to a particular dark zone in order to compete against other players to try to get the best loot. Supposedly, the last patch that came out either today or very recently made it so that the dark zone is no longer a requirement. But also, another problem I have with Rainbow Six, The Division, or sorry, Tom Clancy's The Division, is that it seems very samey. Oh, you get the same gun, only just stats are better. Which is part of the problem that I had with Borderlands when it came down to it, was that Borderlands 1, you had a lot of interesting weapons that did some unique things. But it seems like Borderlands 2, they forgot that, you know, that was a thing.
Yeah, Borderlands 2 went for, we've got 1,000 kajillion guns that are all, you know, roughly the same.
We have 18 quadrillion planets.
That are all roughly the same.
Oh,
So, I find it interesting that we're ignoring several games on this list.
yeah, really?
Like
I
World
mean,
of
we're.
Warships, what the heck is that doing on there?
Yeah, I have no idea.
One, the multiplayer experience in World of Warships is not all that great unless you're playing with friends, which I don't think that's enough to get a game anywhere because most games you can say, oh, this game is better if I play it with my friends.
Well, if
Plus,
we're
it's in
saying that, then
beta.
we have to take out keep talking and nobody explodes, because that's something you definitely don't want to do with somebody random.
But I mean, World and
But I
plus
think
World of
it's more
Warships in
World of
beta.
Warships isn't out.
Street Fighter V,
It had some
it
severe
has
issues
some
when on
severe
launch.
issues. It still has some netcode issues.
I wasn't sure if it had been fixed or not.
No, a couple of podcasts I listen to, there are people who like the game, and the general sentiment is, well, it's better than launch, but it still has problems.
And also, didn't it do a weird thing where it basically launched as a bare bones game and did a bunch of updates way post launch to try to just get the game out for the tournaments?
It was a like a triple A early access game because
But
it
which
only
didn't
launched.
label it as an early access game. That was the big thing.
It launched with only, I think, the story mode, training mode, and the basic online 1v1 fighting mode. And all of the other stuff didn't launch with the game.
Yeah,
So.
that just takes it out of contention.
Yeah.
Pro Evolution Soccer, I don't know enough about. Halo 5, don't know enough about.
Well,
FIFA, don't know.
Halo did some interesting things with Halo 5. A couple of interesting things in terms of like modes that they created. I mean, basically they added a MOBA mode, a first-person MOBA mode that had like massive, or it had like multiple lanes and massive things that you could call in and power-ups and all that jazz, but really, it was the same old Halo experience with a new face. Plus, they added awful microtransactions to the game, like horrible, horrible
Yeah,
microtransactions. Like,
that's been pretty much the entire thing I've seen about Halo
and in my
5 was
opinion,
just
that,
all the microtransactions.
and I think that disqualifies it. Just the microtransactions disqualify it from being on the list because it's not like I know that Rainbow Six Siege has microtransactions, but you can get basically a starter version of the game, and the standard game gives you lots and lots and lots of the in-game currency. So it's a little bit, it can be frustrating, but it's a little bit less so than in Guardians. Like, in Guardians, basically, if you don't spend microtransactions, it takes you like something like an additional 200 hours to get all of the content unlocked for you. And I
Only.
mean, yeah, only. And I mean, I like Halo, but I don't want to spend 200 hours just to get everything.
Yeah, sometimes it feels like I won out whenever I just didn't pay attention to Halo when it was pretty clear that they weren't going to really do anything with the PC versions. But yeah, I would say Overwatch is still the winner on this with for me, Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes just because it's so novel.
And I agree that Overwatch is the winner. I mean, it is this year's multiplayer game and honestly like a serious game of the year contender for a lot of people. But for me, Rainbow Six Siege is its like close second.
Okay, so best indie game. The winner for this was Firewatch. And it's really a who's who for this list. Banner Saga 2, Fury, Hyper Light Drifter, Inside, No Man's Sky, which, get the fuck off this list. You're backed by Sony.
Sony pretty much funded that game.
Oxenfree, Pony Island, Starbound, Stardew Valley, Superhot, The Witness, and Undertale.
Undertale is another game that came out it
Yeah,
last year.
and has been pretty much everybody's darling.
Yeah, it was everybody's darling last year.
Yeah, when did that real? Well, it released September 15th, 2015. So if they're doing financial years, yeah, it probably fits in. That's the problem, is that we have to try to figure out, yeah, where the cutoff is. Firewatch is definitely a contender. I would say, well, Stardew Valley was just amazing. If you liked Harvest Moon, Stardew Valley was Harvest Moon, but better in pretty much every way.
Yeah, I think I'd have to say, I mean, Firewatch is great. That's definitely a real contender. I think, though, I'd have to say Pony Island.
I don't really know a lot about Pony Island.
Pony Island is one of those, it's a meta game. Like,
No.
it starts out and you think that Pony Island is just like this really cheap kind of endless runner game. And but there's certain tasks that you can do and certain things, and suddenly you start discovering like a lot of interesting things about the world of Pony Island and the game. Like you pick up clues for what you need to do, and eventually you go and you rewrite the code to the game to based on what it tells you, which unlocks like the real game.
Yeah, I've had
It's
it on my wish list for a while. It's just, yeah, it's one of those almost filler games.
fascinating how much effort and time was put into this game. That honestly, a lot of people were really turned off in the beginning because they didn't want to put in the time. And I totally get that. Like, I mean, the developers took a risk, but or a risk. But for me, that's a big contender just because of how much that developer did with that game. But there's also a couple other games. I mean, I have not personally played Stardew Valley.
Yeah, like I
I
said,
want to, it's
Stardew
on my
Valley is
list.
essentially Harvest Moon Plus.
Yeah, it's on my list. I know I'd like it. I just haven't gotten around to it yet.
What was hilarious was there was some real campaigning to try to just usurp this and put No Man's Sky on every award that it won or that was nominated for.
Well, I'm glad that did not happen.
Yeah, I'm gonna give it to Stardew Valley myself. Firewatch is, like I said, a really good, real contender, but I don't know it well enough. But Banner Saga 2 is supposed to be really good as well.
Yeah.
Fury is also really good.
I could see Superhot being on there too.
Yeah.
Because
Yeah,
Superhot did some really inventive things.
my only problem with Superhot is that it's so damn short.
Yeah, that's fair.
I mean, I know I'm a big gameplay guy, but it's only a couple hours long.
Yeah. I'd probably say either Firewatch or Pony Island.
Yeah,
Both of
and I
those
would
are my
go
two main
Firewatch
contenders.
or Stardew Valley just because I know Stardew Valley. Granted, Pony Island, if I had experience with it, I'd probably lean towards it as well because it looks interesting.
Yeah.
So, best gaming moment in association with Absolute Radio.
Yeah, this is very specific and probably, I mean, it sounds like a sponsored thing. I don't know that for
Yeah.
sure, but it
Oh,
really
it's
seems
definitely a
like,
sponsored thing.
yeah.
I mean, it's an association with.
Yeah.
And there are a couple minor spoilers in this.
Yeah.
Well, we'll just go ahead and dive into it. What the hell? The winner was Play of the Game in Overwatch. Yeah.
All
That's a
right.
thing.
Cool.
I would say that would be a feature and not a gaming moment.
Yeah.
Let's see. Climbing the tallest building in Mirror's Edge Catalyst. These are the nominees. Flying the Millennium Falcon in, well, it says flying the Falcon, but I'm assuming the Millennium Falcon
Yeah, I
in
would
Star Wars
assume.
Battlefront. The return of Abnor Londo in Dark Souls 3. And Kyle's probably cursing me at the pronunciation of that, but Kyle, it's my thing. I fuck up names. The Brotherhood of Steel arriving in Fallout 4. The car chase in Uncharted 4. The ending of Inside, unleashing the BFG 9000 in Doom, and unlocking the secret of Psalm 46 in The Witness.
I mean, yeah.
I'm not sure if I could really comment on any of these because I haven't played these, so I don't know the moment.
This is really tough because for me, I'm familiar with some of these things, and for me, the winner is Brotherhood of Steel arriving in Fallout 4. But that game came out last year, and so we don't know how
Yeah.
we feel about that. That moment, though, was amazing.
Yeah, but they're all, but here's the thing is that this award is also, they start voting in, well, in October, so maybe it's September to September.
Yeah. I mean, out of all the moments, the Brotherhood of Steel arriving in Fallout 4 was the best. Oh my gosh. That was so exciting. I hesitate to say too much because I don't want to
Yeah.
spoil it very much, but It was great. When it happens, just stop and take it in. It's glorious.
Yeah, I'm not really sure if I could really comment on any of these. If the gameplay was better, I would say that flying the Millennium Falcon in Star Wars Battlefront would definitely be a contender, but the fighting mechanics in that game, especially for air, just seemed to be off.
Yeah, it doesn't seem very special to me though. I mean, I've been able to fly the Millennium Falcon in
Yeah, the fact
every
that it
Rogue
happens.
Squadron game,
Yeah, well,
and
and also the fact that it happened so often in Battlefront.
yeah.
If it was, you're usually flying an X-wing, and then you're a 1 in 1,000 chance that, oh, you're flying the Millennium Falcon instead.
Yeah. The car chase in Uncharted 4 was pretty cool. They used that during their E3 demo. But diff, yeah, it's definitely a Brotherhood of Steel for me. I don't know if you remember this or not, but we were chatting on TeamSpeak or something whenever I actually got to that moment in the game, and
Yeah.
you were like, "Don't spoil it, whatever it is, don't spoil it."
Yeah.
So I don't think I even told you it was a Brotherhood of Steel appearing, although I mean now you know, but great moment. Great moment.
Moving on,
Yeah.
because I really can't comment on any of these.
Yeah, I can't comment on any more of them.
Okay, so the most wanted game in association with Green Man Gaming. The winner is Mass Effect Andromeda, which I could see why, but at the same time, all the things that happened with Mass Effect 3, yes, I've realized that it's a lot that's in the last half hour of the game, just kind of left a foul taste in my mouth when it comes to the Mass Effect series as a whole.
Yeah. I'm incredibly excited for Mass Effect Andromeda. That's
It's the fact that it is essentially a side story and that they're breaking away from Mass Effect in general is probably a good thing for me, just with how I feel about the Mass Effect series.
Yeah, I really like that move. A lot of people don't, but I think it's good for them to get away from the main series and do another game that's not focused around Shepard.
Well, let's dive into the rest of this list. The nominees were Warhammer 40K, Dawn of War 3, which I'm very interested in. Days Gone, God of War, which, wait, didn't that come out a few years ago? I'm sorry. Oh, why do they keep using the same fucking titles over and over again?
Brand recognition.
Horizon Zero Dawn, Resident Evil 7, Scalebound, Sea of Thieves, Shenmue 3, Spider-Man, Star Citizen, and The Legend of Zelda: Breath of the Wild.
There's several really good games, or at least good-looking games, on this list.
Yeah, the thing is that it really comes down to how they play, and the thing is, we don't know that.
Yeah, the only one of the games on these lists that we know anything about how it works is Star Citizen.
Yeah, ironically enough, huh?
Yeah. But, I mean, out of all the games on the list, I'm definitely the most excited for Mass Effect Andromeda. As long as it reviews well and doesn't have any major problems, that'll be a game that I pick up brand new. I only get one or two, maybe three of those a year.
Let's put it this way. Spider-Man game, PS4 game. Fuck it.
Actually, I'll probably get Mass Effect Andromeda on Xbox because Katie likes to play the Mass Effect series.
Legend of Zelda, that's a Nintendo game, so I'm never going to play that.
Yeah, I don't really care about the Zelda franchise very much,
Star Citizen,
anyways.
I'm interested in, but I have so many red flags with just, how much they promised.
Yeah.
And yes, I realize that's the same thing that I said about No Man's Sky, but good point about No Man's Sky, huh?
Yeah. I still
Shenmue
can't
3
get.
is I've never played the earlier Shenmue game, so it's more of I haven't played the earlier one, so it's hard for me to get excited.
I've played the earlier Shenmue games, but I mean, they were all right. Not enough for me to be really excited for. I mean, if Shenmue 3 comes to PC, I'll probably pick it up eventually, but it's nowhere near the top of my must-buy list.
Yeah, Sea of Thieves, that's the heavily co-op multiplayer game, isn't it?
Yeah, the one during E3 where they had like
The cringeworthy real players.
yeah, all those YouTubers or whatever.
Yeah.
And that game looks neat, but
Yeah,
yeah.
it would be definitely a game that I would love to play with you guys, but the thing is that it's, once again, a very niche game, and Let's see, Scalebound, that was the dragon game that they had a bunch of heavy metal playing during.
Yeah, that's for, I believe it's an X, well, I mean, it would be an Xbox and Windows Store exclusive, but.
Well, they said Windows on my quick search for it, so possible. Resident Evil 7, don't really care.
Yeah, I don't really care either.
Horizon Zero Dawn, I don't recognize that name offhand, and I'm looking at it's PlayStation 4, so fuck it. God of War, PlayStation
Oh,
4.
Horizon Zero Dawn is the like the future apocalypse game
Oh
with
yeah,
robot
that okay.
dinosaurs.
Okay, looking at that, now I recognize it. I look at the screenshots once again. Yeah, once again, PlayStation 4 though.
Yeah, it looks
So
cool, but it's a PS4 exclusive, so for
yeah,
now.
God of War, PlayStation 4 exclusive. So, I'm bereft of any choice here. So it's either Mass Effect, which I don't really care about, Days Gone, which I'm pretty sure is PlayStation 4 exclusive as well.
Yeah, that's that weird
Yeah, this is
zombie
a
game.
come on. This is like the PlayStation 4 console list. So I have a choice between Star Citizen, which I have red flags about, Shenmue 3 maybe, Sea of Thieves, which I don't really care about. I gotta give it to Warhammer 40K Dawn of War 3, just because, it's my only choice.
That's fair. But I mean, this category is 100% personal. What are you
Yeah.
excited for? This or this? Well, all
Well,
right.
it's more, well, fuck, that's console. Console. Two consoles. Console that may actually release in March.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's. Oh,
Did you
so.
know? Did you know? Sorry, this is a little bit of a sidetrack, but did you know that Legend of Zelda: Breath of the Wild, launch title, launch title, launch title, no longer a launch title for the Switch. It's been
So
replaced by a Mario game.
so they've confirmed that it's not going to be a launch title. I hadn't seen that.
Yeah, they confirmed. I didn't pull it up as a news story this week because honestly, I forgot about it. That's how little I care. But now that that's come up, I remember seeing that this week. There, a lot of people are mad because they withheld Breath of the Wild supposedly to
Yeah,
make it a launch
they've been
title for the
holding on to
Switch.
this.
It's not
As
going
a
to
matter
make
of
it.
fact, the Wii U is no longer being produced now, or is ceasing production. I can't remember which it is. So, yeah, Nintendo is doubling down on the Switch actually doing something.
Yeah. I mean, on the one hand, I'm proud of Nintendo for not releasing a game if they don't feel like it's ready. But on the other hand, it's like, dude, come So. I just had to get that out there.
Yeah. Yeah, that's absolutely hilarious. And the fact that, replacing it with a Mario game, Mario is going to be a launch title no matter what.
Yeah.
The Switch really is going to need Zelda. It needs a heavy hitter. Yes, I realize Mario is still a heavy hitter these days, but you need something a little deeper.
Need
And
some
that's
Zelda and some Pokemans.
yeah, and honestly, Zelda, what I've seen preview wise, which they've done a lot of preview for that game.
Yeah.
It looks like it would be a system seller if they could actually release the fucking game.
Yeah.
So, speaking of system sellers, let's go to Game of the Year.
Yeah.
Kyle's gonna be really excited because the winner was Dark Souls 3. And the nominees were Deus Ex Mankind Divided, Doom, Fallout 4. Wait for you to object.
I object.
Hitman, Inside, No Man's Sky.
I object.
I just cackle. The fact that they actually kept No Man's Sky on this list.
Yeah.
Or the really funny ones further down. Pro Evolution Soccer 2017. Pokemon Go, because that was a fucking game.
Oh, then you might be mad at me for what I think the game of the year should be.
Oh boy. We're gonna have to agree to disagree then, I guess.
Yeah.
Rise of the Tomb Raider, The Witness, Total War Warhammer, which Total Warhammer, Uncharted 4 at Thief's End, and XCOM 2.
Yeah. So, first of all, I'm glad to see that Overwatch did not win. I don't mean that maliciously, but It's just like Overwatch has been just such a huge game this year that's kind of dominated a lot of the news
Yeah.
space. And it's not that it's a bad game, but I feel like there are many
And
other
also your porn habits.
Yeah. But I feel like there are many other games out there that are just as good, if not better, than Overwatch. And from my own personal feelings, I don't feel like Dark Souls 3 is, but I also acknowledge that the Dark Souls series are really good games that just don't appeal to me. So I could see Dark Souls 3 as a fair contender.
Now,
But
here, I'm not sure what I would honestly pick. Well, just for one, that a lot of these games are on my to-do list at some point.
yeah. Well, personally, I don't feel like Fallout 4, not only because it came out last year, but also Fallout 4 was not, I
Yeah,
mean, it was a good game, but it was not a great game, not game of the year material game.
it's really gone the path of how Bethesda has gone in general, where they've gone more quantity over quality.
Yeah. Plus, Fallout 4 is really showing the age of its engine. If the next.
Skyrim was showing the age of the engine.
That's very true. But Fallout 4 is even
Oh, I
worse.
just wait till next week when I tear into the engine. I would say Overwatch is a contender. Rise of Tomb Raider, perhaps. The Witness, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
Total War, if they gave it a year of patches, because the Total War games always release in absolute terrible state.
Yeah.
And I think Warhammer was no exception to that rule.
Uncharted 4 is a good game, but I don't think it's good enough to make this list. When
Hitman
we
was
get to the.
interesting. It was supposedly it's a gone back to the roots of Hitman.
Yeah, but it released in that weird.
Yeah, it has that weird subscription thing, and they've just announced that they're doing a second season for it.
Yeah, so I don't
Yeah,
know.
so
Supposedly.
how do you classify that?
Well, Hitman also has, I don't know if they ever fixed them, a lot of technical issues with people like losing
Yeah.
save games. And it's an always online game, even for console. You can't play Hitman offline for more than
Wow.
like 15 minutes. Like it gives you like a little grace period so that you can save and then the game shuts down.
Sheesh.
And I think that feature takes it off the list, period.
Yeah, there's just so many games here that have issues.
Yeah.
And looking at this list, actually, okay, the indie games would be Pokemon Go,
Sort of.
Pro Evolution Soccer, sort of,
Yeah.
Inside,
Yep, definitely inside.
and that's it.
Yeah.
I'm not seeing anything else that would be considered indie.
Nope, me neither.
The Witness, maybe?
What'd you say? Sorry.
The Witness?
Yeah, The
Or
Witness is
was
indie.
that was really backed by Microsoft, wasn't it? Microsoft or Sony, I can't remember. I
I'm not
remember it was
sure.
big on being promoted by at E3. But yeah, The Witness would not be on my short list.
Okay.
It's just it's sitting here trying to pick out which game had the fewest issues in general, really,
I think for
with
me,
how this
my.
year gone.
Yeah. I think for me, my list would be Doom. Doom was a great
Yeah,
game.
Doom is probably the best launch on this list.
Yeah, Doom is a great game. I'll be really surprised if it doesn't make, people's game of the year lists. I don't know if it's the best game of the year, but it is a really solid
Yeah, I would
title.
say the only blemish on Doom is its multiplayer.
Yeah, that kind of shoehorned feeling multiplayer, which honestly is Deus Ex Mankind Divided's biggest issue. Well,
Yeah.
one of its two biggest issues. But I think that the major problem with Deus Ex is all the publisher's fault because they forced the developers to include the multiplayer mode with microtransactions.
Yeah, I was about to say all the microtransactions on Deus Ex.
And that's 100% confirmed. Like devs have come out to speak out against
And
that.
the fact that they actually disabled that for the review copies as well is just a scummy move.
Yeah, and the other problem I have though with Deus Ex is that it just kind of ends. Like it feels like a game that there's another, it like Deus Ex Mankind Divided feels like the first half of a game. And that's probably a publisher decision to split up the game to make more money. Surprise, surprise. So, but I think that those two things are enough to take it off the list just because of, I mean, nothing that the devs did wrong. It's all the publisher's fault in that case.
Yeah.
But so, yeah, for me, my
I would
list
say my
is.
short list would be maybe Dark Souls 3. I don't have enough experience with it or the series. Overwatch, which just how crazy it's been. And there's been, outside of some of the microtransaction things, once again,
Yeah.
No real problems with it. But then again, it's also, we talked about this before. The design for all the characters is really great, but then you get into the actual gameplay and it's, a pretty standard FPS with ultimate abilities.
Right.
Doom would also be on my short list, and maybe Rise of the Tomb Raider, but that feels like I'm stretching there.
Yeah. My list is, I think, Doom, Overwatch, and Pokemon Go, which.
Only reason why I'm not mocking with Pokemon Go is just how absolutely absurd it was for about a week, and then it seemed like everyone forgot about it.
Pokemon Go is still a phenomenon. I mean, like that
Yeah,
massive
but it's
surge that
not.
it
Yeah,
had.
but it's not. Yeah, it's it, everyone was talking about it for a week, and then it just fell off.
Yeah, but it's still making more money than Candy Crush and all of the
Yeah,
other
because they have the
major.
whales. That's the thing.
There's still something like ten or
It's
15 million users for Pokemon
yeah. It's
Go.
just so the mobile market is just so weird, where it's this very, very small percentage propping up all these games.
The primary reason that I'm giving it to Pokemon Go, though, I mean, all of that phenomenal stuff is great and all, but I think that Pokemon Go deserves some respect or some worth or something from the fact that it basically is pioneering a new type of game in the ARPG
Well, the
style. Or
thing is,
not the ARPG, sorry, the.
Pokemon Go is based on that company's previous technology and game.
It is.
And as a matter of fact, it's using the same exact stops.
It is, but what's the previous game? Ingress?
Yeah.
Is that what it's called? Ingress
Yeah.
has very little interaction to it aside from go to this place, stay there long enough to get, yourself counted and then leave. Pokemon Go layers on some additional gameplay elements and stuff like that and really makes it feel like a true augmented reality game. And yeah, me and you had problems with it, but lots of people really love it. And I think that they get some massive brownie points for kind of
Yeah, but it
pioneering a
feels
new
like
style of
Pokemon
game.
Go should have been more. They're slowly, slowly, very slowly trying to get towards.
I think that you're right, but also they're the only one. There's no other game like
Yeah, true.
Pokemon Go. And
Yet.
I think that, oh yeah, definitely yet, but I think that that's worth something. And so that's why I'm, pretty solidly backing it.
So, shall we try to come up with a comment for the PlayStation Game of the Year?
I mean, I don't know anything about any of these games, really. A few of a couple of them,
We'll
but
quickly read over it and pretty much skip it. Uncharted 4 won with Abzu, Aptitude, Firewatch, Gravity Rush Remastered, I'm Setsuka, No Man's Sky, Ratchet and Clank, Salt and Sanctuary, Severed, Street Fighter V, The Last Guardian, The
which
Witness.
The Last Guardian's not even out yet. It comes
Yeah,
out
I was about to
in
say.
like
Yeah, I was
2
about to say.
weeks.
Wait, well, I was going to get through the list first.
Sorry, go ahead.
Uncharted: The Nathan Drake Collection. So, Uncharted's on here twice,
Yeah.
and Yetsuka 5. I can't really comment on any of these, because I've either not played them. I think it's a fucking joke that they're on the list. Looking at you, No Man's Sky.
Yeah.
Or that
And
they're PlayStation exclusives, and I can't really comment at all.
yeah. I mean, I know a few things about some of these games, but most of them also have PC ports that I know about,
Yeah,
so.
that would be why I would know a few of these.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I would know The Witness because it's a PC game, also, and I would know it from that. I would know, I definitely know No Man's Sky from just the clusterfuck that that's been.
Yeah.
Firewatch, Abzu, just by looking it up recently. So yeah, I really can't comment on this.
Yeah. I mean, Uncharted 4 is a great game. It probably is the best one on the list. So I guess let's just move on.
Yeah, moving on to the Nintendo Game of the Year. Like, I just realized something. There's no Xbox Game of the Year on here, is there?
Isn't it the, is it at the bottom?
The bottom is competitive.
Oh no, there's no Xbox. Interesting.
I went down. I was like, then I saw PC. It's like, wait a minute, there's no Xbox here.
That's
Well, that tells
interesting.
you how Xbox was doing. I didn't even notice that when I was originally reading it out. Well, Nintendo Game of the Year: Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess HD, which won that category, which it says a lot that a remaster won this category.
Yeah.
The nominees were Fire Emblem Fates, Kirby Planet Robobot, Legend of Zelda Triforce Heroes, Monster Hunter Generations, Pokken Tournament, which is supposedly really good, but hardly anybody's playing it anymore. Tokyo Mirage Sessions FE, or hashtag FE, or hashtag Fee, or whatever the fuck that's supposed to be. Xenoblade Chronicles X and Yokai Watch, or Yokai Watch.
Yeah, I don't know very many of the games on this list.
Yeah, and the fact that the Nintendo's had a very weak year, it seems like.
Xenoblade Chronicles X, I do know a bit about that game, and Xenoblade Chronicles X was great.
Yeah, that's basically oh shoot, now I'm blanking on a massive fighting game with Zelda characters, right?
No, Xenoblade Chronicles is an RPG with
No, I was talking
giant
about the Zelda
monsters and
game.
giant mechs. Oh, the Zelda game.
Zelda Triforce Heroes.
Triforce Heroes is a really weird three-player multiplayer Zelda
Or
game.
no. What am I thinking of? Because there was a Legend of Zelda game that I guess it's coming out then that was
No.
supposedly supposed to be just massive fighting.
No, that game
Or did
came
it
out
just not
last
make,
year.
I guess it just didn't make the list then.
It came out last year. It might have actually come out in 2014. That's.
This shows you just how much I pay attention to Nintendo these days.
Yeah. Legend of Zelda. What is that game called? I know what it is. I just can't think of the name of it right now. But
Or
yeah,
really care.
I don't really care either. I think the only reason Xenoblade Chronicles X didn't win, honestly, is because it's not your typical Nintendo game.
Yeah, and it can't beat a remaster of Twilight Princess, obviously.
Yeah. Okay.
So let's go on to a category that we could actually talk about for once.
Yeah.
PC Game of the Year. Winner was Overwatch because we got to kiss its ass some more. Nominees were Sid Meier's Civilization VI, Doom, Masters of Orion, Conquer the Stars, Stardew Valley, Stellaris, Total War, Warhammer, Undertale, World of Warships, What's That Doing There Still, and XCOM 2.
Yeah.
Also a very weak list. Not as strong as I was expecting it to be, I should say.
No, there were a
Because
ton of good games that came out this year on PC.
that just didn't make this list for some reason.
Out of what's on the list, I'd probably have to say Doom.
Well, Overwatch is definitely a contender, like I said, with just how crazy it's been.
Yeah, Overwatch is definitely a contender,
Civ
but
6 is also somewhat a contender, but I'm the Civ games always need expansions. And talking with Kyle, the systems are there. It's just some of them aren't as fleshed out as they should be.
yeah.
Doom is definitely a contender. I would give Stardew Valley somewhat of a contender, but it's still an indie game and a very niche one at that. Total War Warhammer is it needs work. Stellaris, I don't know enough about. I know it's a 4X game. And I'm just looking at screenshots of it. I recognize it, but the thing is that I don't know enough about it. Undertale, was last year, and it would be a definite contender though. World of Warships, no idea why that's there. And XCOM 2 is also last year.
No, XCOM 2 came out this year.
Or was it barely this
It
year?
came out in, I believe, February.
Oh, it came out in February. All right. So XCOM 2 would be a contender as well.
Yeah, XCOM 2 is really good, but stacked up against some of the other things on this list, I think it falls short of a game of the
Yeah, I guess
year.
Overwatch has to go for it.
Yeah, I mean
And it's more fighting out, who comes in second. It's more, personal taste at that point.
yeah, I think that I honestly think that Doom gives Overwatch a real run for its money. I mean, Doom
Well,
was
it's just well,
phenomenal.
here, well, here's the thing. Here's the thing is that it's really coming down to single player versus multiplayer for your FPS.
That's true. It's very true. So,
And there's been a definite leaning towards multiplayer games in this list.
yeah.
Just winners. Dark Souls 3, Overwatch, just winning category after category. So, yeah, I would say that it's definitely Overwatch's year. Just them. I hate using the term sucking up to it just because of just the connotations of it. But, you know, it feels almost like they have to give it to it because Overwatch is nominated.
Yeah, I think I'd agree with you on the rest of the things that you said as well. I mean, I agree with you on what games, stand a chance for a nomination, or a runner-up spot. So,
Okay, so let's move on to the last category, finally.
yeah, we've been doing this for a long time.
Yeah, and I've been talking quite a bit, and my throat's starting to get a little raw. Oh, the last category is competitive game of the year. Can I guess what won this?
I mean, I'm looking at it, but I mean,
Well,
it's
it's more talking to the
Overwatch.
listeners.
Yeah.
Yeah, Overwatch, with the nominees being Call of Duty Black Ops 3, Counter-Strike Global Offensive. What the fuck is this doing on the list?
Yeah.
Because this is several years old, isn't it?
I think
Dota 2 is also kind of old, isn't it?
Counter-Strike
Or
2 and or Counter-Strike Go and Dota 2 are both older games.
yeah, what are these doing on the list? Can you explain this?
No, I cannot.
Initial release for Dota 2 was 2013, unless it had some sort of, coming out of beta or early access thing going on. Let's see, FIFA 17, Hearthstone, Heroes of Warcraft, Heroes of the Storm, Killer Instinct, Season 3. So yeah, definitely not the first two seasons. League of Legends. Why is this on the list?
Yeah, same with Smite.
Yeah, Smite is on the list as well. StarCraft: Legacy of the Void, so an expansion there, which I think that came out this year.
I believe it did. I think it came out towards the beginning of the year.
And Street Fighter V.
So,
No, Legacy of the Void came out in November 2015.
oh, it did. Okay. I thought it came out this year. Well,
So it's more, I guess we can't find competitive games, so we're just going to put the same ones on the list time and time again.
yeah. Honestly, I don't think Overwatch is the winner. I mean, Overwatch, if it was multiplayer game of the year,
Yeah.
sure. But the competitive scene for Overwatch isn't really there. Blizzard does this thing where they try to make all of their games esports games.
Yeah, and
And
all of them fall apart except for really StarCraft.
yeah. And it's not that Overwatch doesn't have potential,
But
but there's a lot of systems in place for other games that Overwatch doesn't have. That makes it a more difficult esport to follow.
how are we looking at this? Are we looking at it as competitive multiplayer or competitive as an esport? Because that's two vastly different things.
That's fair, but isn't every game on this list except for FIFA an esport?
Yeah, I'm sure the esports scene for Heroes of the Storm is absolutely huge.
It's got an okay esports scene, but it's again Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah, I was going to make a snide comment about Killer Instinct, but yeah, that's the fighting game scene.
Yeah.
And they latch onto really serious and just follow them nonstop.
Yeah.
So
So
it's more coming down to, what is the esport game of the year then with this list, just with how they handled it? And honestly, it's going to come down to either League of Legends or Dota.
I think Counter-Strike goes up there too. I mean, they've had their knocks this year with the whole gambling thing, but as an esport, Counter-Strike Go is really popular still.
Yeah, but I'm just looking at the absolute huge beast that is both League of Legends and Dota on the tournament scene.
Yeah. StarCraft 2 also has been on the decline this year.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still got a big scene, but the scene is getting smaller. It's
Yeah,
just,
just with how Blizzard has handled it.
yeah.
And
Plus,
also,
winds change,
I think, and I think there was some distaste over some of the things that they introduced with Legacy of the Void, but I don't follow the StarCraft scene nearly enough to be able to say exactly what they were.
Yeah. I also don't know a ton. I mean, I know the basics of esports, but I don't follow esports, so I don't feel super qualified to make a judgment call. Based on what I know, I would have to say either League of Legends or Counter-Strike Go, But honestly, you could probably argue me into a position for most games on this list. I would not at all accept Hearthstone or
Yeah,
Heroes of the Storm.
Hearthstone is so random that you can't really make it an e-sport.
The only way you can
There's
make it
just
an esport is to do banned cards lists, but
and that's hardly any fun, especially since Hearthstone, even after all this time, doesn't exactly have a huge card list to begin with. And they've also gone this route where they've gone a banned card list for the well, not competitive, but for the ranking system.
yeah.
And they're essentially making it where it's impossible to keep up with because they're banning everything but the basic cards and the newest, what was it, two sets.
Yeah, it's the most recent two sets.
And yeah,
So,
good luck keeping up.
yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. I don't think Overwatch is there's an esport, at least not yet. But otherwise, I don't know how to tell you who a winner would be.
I think it's going to be the one of the MOBA games, personally.
Yeah.
And it's Smite is a distant third in the MOBA market right now. It's really Dota and League of Legends trading blows with Riot. Just seems like they just fumble every so often and just lose ground because of it.
Yeah. All right. Well, that wraps up this rather long podcast topic. Let's take a look at our recording time. We're at the 2 hour mark minus our little break that we did, which will cut out a couple of 3 minutes.
Showing 1 hour of 57 minutes right now.
Right. So that's about what I was thinking on the
I say
timer.
we try to get at least the Ubisoft topic.
Okay. Then our next news topic is, let me pull the topics list back up. Ubisoft is saying gamers will no longer have to buy DLC for a full experience in a game.
I'll believe it when I see it.
Yes, I will believe it when I see it, but
Granted, Ubisoft has shown some goodwill with Rainbow Six Siege with the starter pack and also make it so that the maps aren't locked into map packs. They're free releases. But this is one game compared to the entire backlog of how Ubisoft has been fucking people over with both their business practices and the absolutely abysmal state of their releases.
right. I did like the analogy that they made, saying if you go to an amusement park, you pay an entry fee that allows you to ride all the rides as much as you want. But then if you want to spend more, you can go to the gift shop or the concession stand. And I think that that's actually a pretty decent analogy to use for this, because it's like
Yeah,
they're.
the only problem with AAA gaming these days is that you get into the park and you have this little section. You're in the kiddie section, and but to get onto the roller coaster, you have to buy the pass to go into the roller coaster area.
Yeah.
And then if you don't like the color of the roller coaster, you can pay a few extra dollars and they'll repaint it for you.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a big fan of no DLC,
Yeah, don't get
like.
me wrong. I like the idea of this. It's just, I've heard a lot of promises, not just from Ubisoft, but really the AAA gaming industry as a whole. And actions speak louder than words.
Yeah.
This right now is lip service and one game supporting it.
Yeah.
Just show me your mini business.
Yeah. I mean, I like the idea behind it as well. I don't trust them yet, but this kind of ties in a lot with Kyle's audio letter, but it's very pertinent here. Companies are seeing the landscape for gaming shift, and people are becoming more and more fed up with predatory practices that these companies use. And I think Ubisoft is saying, okay, maybe we can get away with microtransactions. That seems to make us a lot of money. Let's axe DLC, which has people frustrated and has become less and less accepted over the years. So I don't think they're doing this out of the goodness of
Well,
their
it's just not
heart.
just well, it's not just DLC, but selling chunks of the game, selling levels, selling map packs, selling difficulty levels, just all these little chunks that you really need to make the game complete.
Yeah. So I think that's what they're doing. They're saying, okay, there's this new there's this potential wave coming. Let's see if we can head it off the pass and reduce how much hot water we're gonna wind up in over the next couple of years as the backlash grows
Well, to
towards
borrow
these predatory
another of Kyle's
practices.
analogy, Ubisoft is trying to change the rudder and steer the ship, but it is a massive ship and it requires a lot of change. They have a lot of momentum behind them with just how they've acted in the last 30 years. Ubisoft is a 30-year-old company. And in the last, I would say, 10, is just so fresh in people's mind with, just how they've churned out game after game after game of these series. What was it? Well, I know it's Activision, but Call of Duty, we only had 1 year missing out of the entire Call of Duty franchise. And it's been pretty much the same with Assassin's Creed.
I think,
And it's just gotten to the point where, they need to do something to change, and they're seeing, okay, let's take a look and see what people are complaining about and what we could change and still make money.
I'm tempted to save this discussion for when we play Kyle's audio letter, but it's really fresh on my mind. I feel like each of these companies are trying to do that in different ways. In Kyle's audio letter that we'll hear here shortly, he makes reference to Activision releasing Titanfall 2 and Battlefield 1 really
EA.
close together. I thought Activision was the overall. No, you're right. You're right. EA. I'm sorry. You're right. My apologies.
They were trying to beat Activision to Call of Duty.
They were trying to basically suck up the entire market for that. And that's a strategy to try and deal with some of this, I think. They're doubling down on their predatory business practices, trying to beat other companies
Yeah,
up.
Ubisoft is trying to
Ubisoft.
change. EA's trying to double down. Activision is sitting there cross-eyed trying to figure out what the hell else to do.
I mean, a lot of these companies are kind of going their own ways with trying to handle it. It's tough to say with Activision because Activision is huge.
Yeah, Nintendo, bringing other major companies in, is trying to merge their handheld and their home consoles into one thing and hoping that works.
No, I mean, Nintendo's going all in on the Switch. If the Switch fails, I mean, Nintendo can probably hang on for a while, but if the Switch is a
Nintendo
big
will.
flop, we might see them go the way of like Atari or
Sega?
Sega, where they become more of a publisher instead of a hardware developer, which that would be a tragedy for the industry in a
Yeah,
number of ways, but.
that'd be a. I almost want to see it happen just to see what happens, Because I would love to be able to have a chance to play, well, a Legend of Zelda game on PC without having to deal with emulators.
Yeah, in some ways it would be a good thing, but I think in more ways it would be a negative thing because we're taking competition out of an already.
Yeah, it would go from the big two with the little one and PC to the big two and PC.
I mean, PC is its own animal, but it doesn't compete in that same space. And PC certainly has its own innovations, but most of the innovation that drives the industry happens on the console side of things.
Well, that's where we kind of lost with the Steam machine, is that it tried to compete with that space, but they never advertised to that space.
What are other companies doing? Microsoft is trying to create its
Microsoft
own.
is trying to consolidate its console with Windows and have their own little playground, and that is absolutely broken. The swings that are hanging from one chain, the seesaw is, just this V, and both seats are down. The slide is just flat on the ground.
Sony, being the industry leader that it is right now, is
It's
doesn't really
busy
seem to be
shooting
doing
themselves in the
much.
foot.
Yeah, they're just keeping on with what they're doing, which is
Well,
what
they're shooting
industry
themselves
leaders
in the
tend to
foot with
do.
the PS Pro and just really letting Microsoft catch up on a lot of things.
What are some of the
Valve
other
is
ones?
making market money off a bunch of Steam trading cards.
Valve is being Valve. They've got fuck you money.
Blizzard is trying to make everything into an e-sport.
Plus I wonder what they're gonna do with WoW.
Yeah, I was about to say it's going to be interesting to see what happens after this expansion, because this has been their emergency design document.
Yeah.
I want to see Warcraft 4, but the problem is that the lore for Warcraft is just such a convoluted mess because of how they had to handle it with WoW.
Yeah.
That they either need to do one or two things. Say that, you know, alternate timeline like they're doing with their current expansion, where the events of World of Warcraft just either didn't happen or happened in a way that allowed the lore to continue on and make somewhat sense. Completely ignore WoW, which, you know, is kind of the same thing, or try to integrate World of Warcraft into Warcraft 4, which, good luck with that, because that is, what, that's 10 years of lore changes.
Yeah.
Active lore changes. Is there any major villains that haven't been killed in WoW?
I don't know. I don't.
Well, let's think about it. Arthas dead. Illidan dead, brought back. And isn't he supposed to be some sort of anti-hero now?
No, I think he's dead again.
I haven't been following the newest expansion that closely.
I think with the Legion lore, like, he was dead and then they brought him back only to kill him again. I'm pretty sure he's dead again.
So Illidan's been double tapped.
Yeah.
Deathwing dead.
Yep.
The old gods, which doesn't really factor into Warcraft, RTS. Three dead that I could think of just off the top of my head out of, was it supposed to be five? So, yeah, they're...
Yeah, I think they
vastly ran out of villains. Unless they start doing the whole people have been corrupted. I know Jaina has been sort of turned into almost an anti-hero, just breaking away from this, trying to bring the Horde and the Alliance together. So there's a possibility there. But, you know, it's the whole thing where Warcraft's heroes get corrupted by some evil force and turn into a villain has been done so many times that, you know, it's laughable.
Yeah.
Thrall is still Jesus to the storytellers, it seems. And he's gone off to raise baby Jesus.
Yeah. Good old Thrall. How many other, like, major companies are there left?
I'm sure that there's some, and I'm just blanking on them.
I mean, there's a lot of big companies I can think of, but they don't have the same sort of market share that we just listed.
Yeah, it's more just, you know, the major, major players.
I think Bethesda's been rising.
Yeah, Bethesda's been going blandy, bland, bland, bland.
Yeah.
With their latest games.
Appealing to the lowest common denominator. Although they've also got their own set of...
And remastering their stuff.
Yeah. They've also got their own set of predatory practices going with their whole no review copies thing.
Do you want to get me started again?
No, I don't want to dive into that again, but I don't know what to think about Bethesda right now. They're a little bit of a wild card for me. Which sucks, because I love Bethesda. I said it before, they were like one of the good ones in my book until here recently, so. You know, we'll just have to see how they go.
And they're kind of cordoning off their mod zone to their own little platform as well.
Yeah.
Which is dangerous because, you know, Bethesda's tried to monetize mods before.
Yeah. I think that's something a lot of game devs are doing. We had this for a while. We had this sort of everything is in one place and we can all get it. And that place was Steam. And now
everyone's cordoning off and trying to figure out a way to make a buck.
Yep.
Where you need 20 different logins.
Yep. I'm not doing that. Origin's probably going to be the only one who gets any of my money because of Mass Effect.
I haven't even bought a game on Origin.
Oh, I've never bought a game on Origin either. I've got a couple of the freebies. But...
I've technically bought one on Uplay just because I got a code from Newegg.
Yep, haven't bought anything on Uplay either. Just a couple of freebies. And then my games that have showed up there that I purchased on Steam, but that's whatever.
Yeah, I'm just looking at the top sellers right now, seeing if there's anyone that we're missing, and I'm not really seeing anyone.
Right.
So, yeah, I think we've pretty much covered the major players, at least.
Yeah, and we also went
Rockstar.
From...
Rockstar.
Right.
Would Rockstar count?
Yeah, Rockstar's a huge developer. And they do publish a few different things, but Rockstar's honestly always just kind of done whatever it wants to.
Yeah, it's been very playing in the background, and they're busy cranking out all the content for GTA Online and working to try to get all the shark cards in the world.
Yeah. I
Which
mean,
that also feels so predatory, just because of how they've set up GTA Online, where it's such a grind unless you give us $5 and we'll unlock this for you.
yeah. Rockstar is the rock star of the gaming industry. It just kind of does whatever it wants and tells anybody who gets in its way to get the fuck out.
Yeah, and people just put up with it.
Yeah.
And the thing is that they pretty much ignore the PC market until they've gotten as much as they can out of consoles, and then they release their games a couple years later. That's what happened with GTA. We never saw Red Dead Redemption, so we may see the next Red Dead just because of how much of a fervor there was for the lack of that of the previous game. But they are also talking about doing something with multiplayer with that game, which I'm expected to see coyote cards now.
Oh, no, instead of cars, it'd be animal skins. Because that was a huge part of Red Dead, was skinning animals to get crafting materials. You get animal packs.
Give us $5 and you get an eagle feather.
Ponchos. I would pay a lot of money for ponchos. I'm a sucker for that sort of thing. Kind of like Team Fortress hats, only better because they're ponchos. Okay, so now that we've covered that topic and basically had our post Kyle's letter discussion, you want to go to
Yeah.
Community Corner and actually play that letter now?
Yeah, I guess so. And that ties directly into the question of the week. So I'll go ahead and say what that is and give the tweet there as well.
Okay.
The question of the week was, do you think the AAA gaming industry is approaching a tipping point that the bubble is about to burst? And Chemist also chimed in saying, keep upping the dev costs, expecting huge sales, but can't compensate because the industry's soft $60 game limit. Something has to change.
Right. Okay, well, let's play Kyle's letter and then we can have our discussion about the question of the week. Because Kyle said a few things that I thought were interesting and hadn't
Yeah.
considered before. So here's Kyle.
Greetings, J. Arthur and Caffeine Rage. This is Kyle coming at you about, well, the gaming bubble that never was. The question of the week this week is whether we think that the AAA video games bubble is going to burst. Now, while I am not saying that there's not an actual bubble, there is. It's just not a bubble in the traditional sense. See, a bubble usually refers to something where an industry has adopted a bunch of really terrible practices and has basically created a system in which, when the system fails, there will be really either two choices. One, to ensure that the companies don't fail by financially bailing them out, like what happened in 2008 with the home mortgage crisis, or let the company go down and hang them for their crimes, essentially what happened in 2001 with Enron. Now, I can hear you thinking pretty loudly. Now, hold on a second. The AAA gaming industry has adopted a bunch of terrible practices, and they're now starting to see a downturn in sales because of it. The number of games that are released are up, quality is either flat or down in most series, and we're getting yearly sequels of installments for things that nobody even wants anymore. So, how is this not a bubble? Now, in most bubbles, it all comes down to market share. For example, Enron was huge, which is why it took a lot of the stock market down with it. Why was it so big? Well, it was seeking to provide kind of competition to the AEP monopoly on the American power system. And yes, I understand that is a gross oversimplification of what their goals were, but if you want to know more, just go look it up. And with the 2008 financial crisis, while it wasn't all banks universally issuing these really, really high-risk loans, it was the bigger banks, and they were giving marching orders to their branch banks in order to make the most profit out of these things, bundle them up, and give them to Wall Street. Now, in both cases, these were companies that were big enough that their failure would not only affect their stock and their derivatives, but it would also affect other stocks because it would lead to a collapse in consumer confidence. Now, there's three major reasons why this wouldn't cause the same amount of panic on Wall Street, but let's start off with the most depressing one. Video games aren't really considered tradable commodities, and especially the publishers like EA and Ubisoft. While they have a decent stock price and their stock has been on the rise recently, that's mostly because most Wall Street bankers don't really understand what EA or Ubisoft does. Now, I understand that there's an exception to every rule, and there may be some Wall Street guys who are making a profit off of all this, as there are with anything. But more importantly, the lay public doesn't really care too much if the EA stock goes up, down, or sideways. Number two, EA and Ubisoft aren't traditional companies in that they don't produce goods that have scarcity. Yes, I understand that there are physical discs occasionally associated with these games, but by and large, they're dealing with code, and code can be distributed basically ad infinitum without decay. So what this means is there's not really a stockpile of anything that they could deplete if they went under. Yes, a few games would get taken off of Steam, and a lot of games would get taken off of Origin, and all of the games would be taken off of Uplay. But the fact of the matter is, because they're not dealing with a physical good, it is still possible to hold on to these commodities once they become abandonware, or somebody cracks the code and puts it up on the internet. Which brings me to my third point, EA and Ubisoft, and I know I've been using these guys, but just put them in the place of any AAA developer, are not the entire video game industry. You still have development studios that are making games either independently or large studios working on games that are a little bit more niche. Think like Stardock Entertainment, who makes the Sins of a Solar Empire series and the Galactic Civilization series. Now, while they have a very niche audience, the audience is big enough that they can make a profit off of these games. What does this have to do with the bubble? Well, even if the AAA development studios were to implode tomorrow, the entire gaming industry would not be destroyed by all of this. So what's likely going to happen? Well, I can't say for any certainty. I mean, it really depends on the level of bullshit that console people are willing to put up with. Oh shit, the gauntlet just got thrown down. And what you have to understand is at the end of the day, PC gamers have an absolute cornucopia of games to choose from. If they don't like the latest AAA title, they can always go check out a smaller studio's effort. And also, they have access to genres that are not serviced on console very much. For example, turn-based strategy, visual novels, real-time strategy. Well, okay, hold on. That last one actually has dropped off in recent years. That's maybe not a good example. But fact of the matter is, because of what I talked about in a previous audio letter about game console licensing and publishing and how all of that mess works, it's much more likely that you're going to be losing the console people if a AAA studio imploded. Now, that would be a huge problem for console manufacturers to suddenly have a massive hole in their lineup where AAA games used to go. However, this isn't necessarily a bad thing. It would cause a corporate diversity within the console's release cycle. And by that, what I mean is the console developers would have to go out and try to find actual game developers to develop for their console, which would cause new ideas to flourish on the console, where previously there had just been the AAA space. So am I advocating to just let these companies shoot themselves in the foot until they bleed to death? Well, yeah, kind of, I am. See, in Smithian economics, it's basically said that superior products will sell over inferior products if properly marketed and there's a demand and a supply to fill them. Now, as I said earlier in this letter, video games don't actually have a physical supply to speak of, so it's really just based on demand, which is kind of dangerous in its own right, but that is an audio letter for a whole other time. So basically what I'm advocating is let them learn or let them burn. And by that what I mean is if a AAA development studio can learn from their mistakes and capitalize on current market trends, they should be allowed to stay around and make money, and Smithian Economics backs this up. However, if a studio loads their games with really shitty practices like overemphasizing DLC, microtransactions, releasing buggy games, releasing incomplete stories, locking away crucial plot characters behind essentially a pre-order bonus. Well, those companies can basically go and burn in company hell. So what do I think will happen in the immediate future? Well, okay, those of you who know me know I play a lot of chess, and I tend to think three or four moves ahead. So let's pick a AAA company almost at random. Let's call them, oh, I don't know, EA. Now, EA is an interesting case because they hoover up smaller studios, have them develop for them for a time, implement their own really shitty practices into them, and then hang the studios for EA's ideas. Now, more and more gamers are starting to realize that this is the pattern with EA, so give it a few years and EA is probably going to notice a noticeable drop in sales. Now, from there, they have two options. Either produce more games quickly and see an overall reduction in quality, or take a step back and produce fewer games that have a higher caliber of quality and a much more player-friendly focus to them. Now, given the recent drop-off of sales since Battlefield 3 of that series, it looks like EA is actually going to pick the first option and double down on their bullshit. Because when they released Battlefield 1, which, by the way, from what I've heard, is a pretty decent game, they also released Titanfall 2 in very close proximity to that. Now, I don't think that that was a mistake. I think that that was an effort to capture all of the market of the gamers. Those who wanted their futuristic military shooter in order to compete with Call of Duty, and those who are basically interested in a historical war, that is World War I, in Battlefield 1. So when this ultimately blows up in their face, which it is currently in the middle of doing, what we can expect to see is either introspection, a step back, and thoughtfulness on the part of EA leadership, which, by the way, probably isn't going to happen simply because most of the corporate higher-ups are from physical goods and have very, very little experience in digital goods. Or we're going to see an absolute fractal splintering of every single one of their properties that they have a license to. They are going to throw everything at the wall to see what sticks, without realizing that that is both expensive and a very great way to alienate your customer base. I'm not actively cheering on the complete implosion of these companies. That has several horrible implications, specifically at the personal level, where a lot of people would lose their jobs. I am really pushing for change, whether that comes from introspection or implosion. And there are three major points that I think that the AAA development studios could basically use to avert crisis. Number one, guys, real talk, you release way too many games a year. If you just released, you know, like 4 to 6 games a year and had your teams focus on them, put more company resources to them, and made sure that they weren't buggy messes, they would be much more well-received in the general public. And that's not talking about, like, reviews. I'm talking about actual player numbers who buy your game. Speaking of purchasing, also, create a range of prices. Not every game has to be $60. And I'm not talking about creating a more upper range where, say, EA starts charging, I don't know, $80 for their games because they think that they're better. I'm talking about creating diversity in the marketplace. That way, gamers can have a lower bar to entry. Not to mention, a lower priced game is going to move more units and make up some of that difference. Again, see Smithian Economics. And number three, take more creative risk with your games. People don't generally know what they want until they have it. I'm reminded of actually a study done by Prego in the 80s, when they asked an economist to help them design the perfect pasta sauce. And what he came back with was, there is no perfect pasta sauce, and you can't just ask people what they want because they will only tell you what they know. In this case, he found out that about a third of the population liked the regular Prego, a third of them liked chunky with a little bit more tomatoes, but a third of them liked a zesty pasta sauce, which nobody was making at the time. So Prego went ahead and put a zesty pasta sauce into production, and they managed to corner the market for years. Now, the video game equivalent of this would be maybe starting a new IP, maybe exploring new mechanics within an established genre. The possibilities are quite literally endless. So I went way more in depth than I probably needed to with this, but I'm hoping that this spurs on a wonderful conversation between you two and in the VGL community proper. Anyways, it is getting a bit late here, and I should probably go figure out why my server issues are causing Ghost Shark to be kicked out. Sorry, buddy. Anyways, I will talk to you all next time.
And that was Kyle with his novel?
Novella.
Novella, yeah. There you go. Radio podcast novella.
Well, there's been a few of those.
Yeah. So we've already had the discussion about...
I do think Kyle got a little hung up on my terminology with this, because he went into saying that there was never a bubble, but then goes in to really support what we were saying in the first place.
Right.
So I do think he kind of lost sight of the forest for the trees.
And
at least in the beginning.
He had an issue with semantics.
Yeah.
Which
if you're going to have a problem with semantics, you're listening to the Robin podcast.
Yeah. Fair play. So the part that I found the most interesting that we haven't already talked about or covered was how he described the industry of it's like, well, it does have a bubble, but there's all this, there's all of these other entities within it that aren't AAA. And
yeah, which that's part of what I was talking about, that Kyle lost the point. We were talking specifically about the AAAs, not that the indies would survive, that it wouldn't really impact PC players as much as console players, because we have a more diverse gaming library.
Yeah. And I hadn't really thought about it, and us talking about all, or at least most, of the really big developers and publishers made me think, like, even
yeah,
if
it would
they
screw over console players,
yeah, even if they all disappeared overnight on PC, they make up this is just a guess, but I'm going to guess that AAA developers only make up around 15% of the games market on PC. We have PC is the only place that really where AA developers still exist, and then the massive amount of
the
indie
only one
games.
That would really hurt right now would be Valve, just because of Steam.
Yeah.
But even looking at top sellers on Steam right this moment, Planet Coaster is the top seller.
Isn't that is that a AA game or an indie game?
I would call that a AA. I mean, it's Frontier Development, so that's
okay.
Elite Dangerous.
Right. And I mean, Frontier, I would consider them a AA level developer. So I didn't realize Frontier made Planet Coaster.
Yeah, I had to actually go double check that. Then next up would be Sid Meier's Civilization VI. So Firaxis.
Yeah, and Firaxis I would consider a double A as well.
Mm-hmm.
They might be a little bit closer to a triple A than Frontier Studios, but they're still not. They're not, yeah, you know, one of the big boys.
And third up is Dishonored, which is Bethesda.
Right.
Which, Dishonored 2, I don't know why people are buying it right now, because it has some severe performance issues.
Yeah.
Oh.
So two out of the three top games are not a AAA game, which honestly, I'm kind of surprised that even one of them is up there.
Yeah, which if we even go to the Steam stats, current players, Dota 2, Counter-Strike, Global Offensive, Team Fortress 2, Warframe, Civilization 6... GTA 5, Civilization 5. So we have two Civilization games right there.
Yeah.
Ark Survival Evolved, Garry's Mod, Skyrim, Rocket League, Skyrim Special Edition, then Terraria.
Go Terraria.
Rust, Fallout 4, and let's wrap it up with Football Manager 2017.
So it sounds like we've got a whole bunch of indie and AA games. And Bethesda in the top lineup.
And Valve, of course, but this is Valve's playground, so.
Yeah.
And I'm just looking around the list. Paladins is right at the cutoff where I was. Elder Scrolls Online is right there, is a little further down.
Yeah, they had that Ubisoft big sale last week.
Yeah, yeah. Ubisoft is a bit further down with Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege, but that's hardly counting because, that would be more of a Uplay title.
Yeah.
H1Z1 King of the Kill still has 10,000 players. So yeah, it's a huge, huge mix on PC.
Yeah.
And also PC is a really, well, I can't say that they don't throw out the past games because, you know, things do eventually break, but it's not on a 5-year cycle where, you know, all the previous games are no longer work on your current hardware.
Right.
You know, they don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. You know, me upgrading my video card did not make it so that my entire Steam library didn't work and I had to buy it all over again. Unless they did the HD remaster and I had to pay $60 for it.
Yeah. Another thing that I really agree with is I think we need a price continuum. I hate that $60 is the default price for new games, and even a lot of AA and indie developers still stay pretty close to that. But
yeah, the fact that Shadow Warrior 2 was a $40 game on launch was absolutely huge news.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I do agree with Kyle that there needs to be a sliding scale, and it needs to go at 60, maybe 65 being the top, and have it be acceptable to be a, you know, a $30 game on launch.
Yeah.
You know, that isn't an indie title.
Yeah, honestly, I would be okay with the scale going even farther up for standard releases.
That really ties into more of the full price after you start factoring in DLC or season passes and that sort of thing.
Well, I mean, I'm not even including
because
that.
Because if you consider that, then yeah, Fallout 4 would be, what, a $100 game?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm just thinking like games like that, which have the possibility for many dozens, hundreds of hours of gameplay right out of the box. Like, I would be okay with paying more than $60 for those games. But I think that we couldn't really do that because it would be abused. I mean, yeah. That's what's happened here is that $60 kind of became the standard, and a lot of game devs, I feel like, abuse that and don't produce $60 games.
Oh, sorry.
Among others, yes.
But Hello Games is definitely the most recent offender.
Yeah. So. But, I mean, there are plenty of games that I buy that are, you know, $5 games. It's like, wow, this is a $5 game. That's amazing. I'll buy that. $20 games, you know, $30 games.
Myself, I typically wait for sales and just pick things up in the $5 to $10 range.
Yeah. I mean, Transport Fever.
But then again, I also have an absolute huge backlog.
Yeah.
And also get games as review copies.
Yeah.
And that kind of feeds up the more recent games, but that's also indie titles, which start to fall into the, you know, the $5 to $30 category.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Transport Fever, I believe, is like $35 if you buy it brand new and you don't get the discount for the loyalty discount for owning Train Fever. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think that's a really appropriate price for that game. I feel like $60, I don't feel like it's a $60 game. And that's not like to rag on the quality of the game. It's just like, it only does this one thing.
But it does it well.
But it does it well.
Sort of like how I did with RimWorld. That's a $30 game, and I bought it as soon as it went on early access.
Yeah. So, I mean, there does exist.
Matter of fact, I'm just looking at my purchase history, and that is the last game I bought at full price was RimWorld.
Yeah. So, I mean, there does exist room for games to cost less and more than $60, but particularly with the digital environment. I mean, when you buy games digitally, you automatically take around $15 off of the cost of the game because there's no longer manufacturing or transport costs involved, and there's no percentages. Well, I suppose there would still be percentages paid.
There's the cut for Valve, assuming you're still on Steam and not on your own platform, which is why a lot of these game or major game developers are looking at doing their own platform.
Yeah, I did almost say no.
Sorry, platforms.
Yeah, I did say almost no cut going to a retailer, but there is still that.
Yeah, there's still the cut going to Valve. Unless you're going, you know, Ubisoft on Uplay, EA on Origin, or Microsoft and their shitty little Windows 10 store.
Yeah.
If you can find anything among all the mobile ports.
But, I mean, there are still, you know, you're still cutting 10 to 15% off the cost of the game, which is, at the current standard, that's between 5 and 10 bucks. So I think there's room for more, for more of a price spectrum instead of a price point.
Yeah, it's also interesting. Bringing it all back around to Ubisoft, how Ubisoft is actually trying something with Rainbow Six Siege. So maybe that is the future for Ubisoft. I want to trust Ubisoft on saying that, that they'll follow through. But yeah, trusting Ubisoft is a way to, end up missing a kidney or something.
I will say, in kind of Ubisoft's defense, their previous years have been worse than this year. And I don't actually,
Yeah,
I don't know if
because
that's
they.
damning with faint praise or what, but
Well, it's not as bad this year because they didn't release an Assassin's Creed game.
right, which is we feel like that was a very smart decision by them. And they made some other smart decisions this year with this, this most recent announcement and the way they handled Rainbow Six Siege being one of them. So, I mean, they've had their fair share of screw-ups for sure. The whole Watch Dogs 2 nudity thing was a mistake that they.
Yeah, which we didn't even cover that. By the way, they're leaving the dicks in.
Yeah, they are leaving the dicks in, but they're taking the badges out. Which I think that's a mistake. They should either pull both, leave both, or at least give a more thorough explanation. This feels very much like the whole, oh, we can't do female models because it'd be too much
Triggered.
work thing. Somebody went through a whole lot of work to model a vagina.
Now the question is, did they use a photo of someone's vagina or did they draw it themselves?
Ooh, that's interesting. Probably a photo. I imagine it'd be time consuming to draw a vagina from scratch. I don't know. Let's call God and ask him, what was it like to draw that vagina, God?
I didn't know Gaben
Gaben draws all the vaginas.
vaginas. And Kyle draws all the dicks.
Oh yeah. Did you
Do
see
we really have anything else?
Genital jousting? I have to
Yes,
ask.
I saw that,
Okay.
and I saw that it got banned in Australia and New Zealand.
Yeah.
I
So
nearly put that on the docket.
maybe for next time. I need to play genital
But
jousting. It looks like it's right up my alley.
yeah, I was about to say that can have your name written on it anymore.
Yep. Okay, do you have anything
But
else
that's
to.
also going to make your kid ask them serious questions.
Oh, God. Yeah, I'll have to play that in the middle of the night or at the clinic. Just so I don't have to explain that to him.
I could use it as a therapy tool.
It actually might make an interesting therapy tool when discussing sex with people. It's like, here, play this.
And that's how you could write
Absolutely. Tax write-off. For genital jousting. I
it
like this. I like where this is going. Okay, do you have anything else you want to say about Kyle's excellent audio letter this week, or?
not really. I do agree, if they want to keep shooting themselves in the foot, let them bleed.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm a little concerned about some of the companies that we may lose because they're being either too stupid or too greedy.
Or both.
Well, yeah, those two aren't mutually exclusive.
Yep. Oh, excuse
And
me.
EA trying to double down and grab the entire shooter market with two games, not going to happen. That was, I disagree with Kyle. That is a mistake. It was just foolish of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think it's time for some tweets.
All right, let's go to the tweets.
Yeah, and we had, most of the tweets this week were people tweeting smoky pictures. Did you see this?
No, I missed that.
First the story was Smokey the Bear, then Smokey Robinson, and for some reason we got the bandit from Smokey and the Bandit instead of Jackie
I was
Gleason.
gonna say, did anybody put anything from Smokey and the Bandit? If they didn't, I would be sad.
Yeah, but it was the bandit and not the Smokey, which I think someone got confused. And Smokey sausages and yeah it looking at the Twitter feed, it's like, what the hell? But this kind of reminds me of the old Kerbal Cast. You know, everyone starts getting tagged, and you know, by the time it ends, you know, there's enough space for like two letters. That's kind of what I miss, really, from Kerbal Cast. It's just all the tagging and some of the nonsense from Twitter there.
I mean,
now that I mentioned it, it's probably going to happen this week.
Our community is growing large enough to get that all to ourselves. So
yeah, really.
Yeah, I'm cool with that.
So let's see, going on to actual tweets and not just pictures that I can't show, which, oh, by the way, Chemist, you, or not Chemist, but Kyle, you may not want to show your sausage online like that.
Oh, baby, I want to see that sausage.
Oh, okay, Chemist, he took out his 6-year-old DS to go on a Professor Layton binge. Surprised at how small it was. Lower half, it was exactly the same dimensions as Moto G or G3. Yeah, the DS is not, or the DSi is not a huge handheld, is it?
No, the XL. I've got a DSi XL from back in the day. It's pink. That thing's got a nice size screen on it, but, you know, it's the XL. It's not twice as big, but it's like, it's significantly larger.
Kyle just used an i75 today. Thought of recording something, but didn't. And I'm disappointed.
I'm sad, yeah.
Does this mean I have to start using another interstate for him? And make him eventually just road trip and use all the interstates in the United States?
That would be interesting, yeah.
Let's see, A.G. Scott. Have you reviewed Transport Fever on your podcast? I'm a few podcasts behind. Obviously. And then you and him had a little discussion.
Yeah.
And Jim, wrapping things up, cutting yourself on a PC is a hallmark of a bad case. Check out Fractal Design Cases, no sharp edges. Jim, you're missing the point. Well, first of all, you have to have the blood sacrifice. But second of all, when I get myself cut on a case, 9 times out of 10, it's the fucking IO shield, which has absolutely nothing to do with the case whatsoever. It's the fact that IO shields with most motherboards are these little razor fin pieces of shit metal.
Yeah, I will say I do quite like Fractal Design. Every case that I have bought in the last few years has been a Fractal Design case. So he is right that those are good cases, but.
Yeah, but misses the point that it's not the case I'm getting myself cut on. It's the IO shield.
Yeah.
And every motherboard does the same thing where it's these little, very thin metal shields.
Yeah.
And that's the motherboard and not the case. Because it has to be the motherboard. Otherwise, you know, you're going to have to cut it out yourself, and I don't have a Dremel.
I do.
So if you want to send emails to us, you could send them over to vglpodcast@gmail.com or tweet us at vglpodcast on Twitter. Or we do have a Discord, which you'll be able to find the link on our website, videogamelogicpodcast.blogspot.com, and there's a link right there, and you can get into our Discord to contact us. Or our Steam group, which is steamcommunity.com/groups/VGLpodcast, and Jared is hopefully doing more with that these days.
Yep, this last week, not so much, was a little wacky for me, but I've been posting more regularly.
Did I miss plugging anything? Because I keep forgetting the Steam group.
Yes, you did miss our new, but I didn't give it to you, so I'm not holding you accountable. But our new place, our new hosting site.
Place that I'm going to have to learn how to post the damn show notes over there.
It's vglpodcast.podbean.com.
Yeah, you're going to have to add that to the show notes.
I will. Okay.
So on to our weekly picks. And this is going to be a weird one this week just because there wasn't a weekly sale. And we have the Steam Autumn Sale looming. So we are doing I'm doing something different from Jared because I'm contrarian.
Yeah. I suggested that we do kind of our top 3 or 4 games. Well, I originally said top 3, but I couldn't just get 3. I've got too many games on my wish list. So I was able to get it down to 4.
And I did it down to 5. But the thing is that I looked at the list and thought, okay, odds of me buying these games, There's one that I would likely get, and the rest of them were either too new or not technically released. They're in early access so that they wouldn't go on a deep discount that I would be tempted to pick them up. So I decided to do something different and do a recommendation list instead.
Right. So, I mean, I do also recommend, I think, all of the games that I want based on what I
Oh,
know,
well, here's the thing. I could
but
likely recommend the games on my want list, but the thing is, I could definitely recommend my recommendation list.
fair play. How many games did you wind up picking?
I went with five.
Okay. You go first, and I'll basically just slide in between all of yours.
Oh my. Well, the first one up we've already talked a little bit about, it's RimWorld. A Dwarf Fortress Light is the best way to describe it. It's the best one of that genre, where it's a base management game where you're just essentially trying to survive. It uses the same art style as Prison Architect, and there's a lot of people claiming that, oh, this is just a clone of Prison Architect. You're not doing anything different. It's vastly different from Prison Architect. Okay, you do eventually have prisoners occasionally, but still, that's vastly different in that you're being attacked directly. There's a lot more combat in this game, and it is also very moddable. I do a series on RimWorld, and I've heavily modified my game to make it more interesting.
Right, the power of mods.
Yeah, RimWorld has an absolutely insane modding scene behind it. To the point that there's total conversion mods out there already. There's the base game, and the two that I can think of just off the top of my head is there's a Cthulhu-themed one, where you have to fight off Eldritch horrors, and then there's a Mars-themed one, where you're on Mars and it completely changes the game, where you have to deal with oxygen. Your electrical power is a lot more important because you run out of power, life support goes down. You have to have greenhouses. And yes, there is a Martian scenario for that mod as well.
Do you, I was gonna say, do you get to grow potatoes?
Yes.
Nice.
It's just one of those games that I could just lose myself in. And like I said, it is a Dwarf Fortress Lite, so there is a lot of complexity in it, but it's not nearly as crazy as Dwarf Fortress. It's a very accessible, but it doesn't lose its depth because of it.
Right. Okay. Well, the I just kind of rearranged these
And
on
I
the
should say that RimWorld, I'm not expecting a huge discount on. That's the only game on my list that I'm not expecting an absolutely huge discount because it's still in early access. And it's expecting, and there's also going to be a pretty big patch, I would say, in the next month or two, going to Alpha 16. So, yes, I am filling time for you, Jared.
Oh no, that's fine. I just
There's going to be a huge patch, which is going to add a lot more to the game. So, and like I said, it is an early access game, so you are buying early in, but it is a very deep game and a very fulfilling game already, and well worth the price.
Right. Okay, well, I just went and rearranged my list actually from like top to bottom in the games that I want the most so that I could kind of do this properly. So the number one game that I want to pick up this sale, particularly if it drops like 50% or more, is Evercron Legacy. This is sort of a sequel to Evercron Mercenary, but I mean they're not story-based games. They're not really connected aside from being, you know, games that share mechanics and things like that. Evercron is a game that's developed. At least the first one was developed by one dude. The whole game is like 100 and it's only like 100 or 200 megabytes, but it's huge. And it does use procedural. The first one used procedural generation, but it was like specifically directed procedural generation. And so like the whole random stuff is very, you know, to recreate the same world every time and just make the game super compressed. And Evercon Legacy is supposed to just expand on that with bigger world, more ships, a better AI, better graphics. The Evercon series is rooted in hard science. So, I mean, it does have like the whole sci-fi, like inertial dampeners or whatever that you can use if you don't want to have to deal with it. But if you turn those off, You have to deal with real orbits and real physics and things like that. So it can get incredibly complicated, but it's also stupid fun to have, space fights having to deal with real physics and things like that. And that also means you basically can accelerate to infinity. But then that results in
And
huge
beyond.
and beyond. But those results in huge crashes whenever you slam into something at, 100 kilometers a second or more. But if you, I think the best way to describe this game is if you really wanted to like No Man's Sky, this game delivers on those promises, except for in like universe size. But I mean, you can do anything. There's different ship types for trading, mining, fighting. You start with like little fighters, but you can get larger and larger ships. You can, I mean, there's no specific story to it, so you basically just have to kind of go and make your own adventure. But there's just diplomacy and warring factions and things like that. You can get really involved and do all kinds of stuff. So I loved the first one. I played it for, I don't know, a million billion hours. Probably not that many, but a few hundred. I own it on Steam, but I actually bought it from the guy back when he just had like a little website that was like, "Hey, check out my game. Here's a demo. If you like it, it's like $20." And I loved it. So, I've been looking forward to this game for a while. It released at the beginning of the year, but the price has kind of come down a little bit over time. But there just have been so many games. I was like, "Well, I'll pick that up when it goes on sale eventually." And I'm hoping that this is the sale. So that's one for me.
All right, so I'm up next with some Wang, Shadow Warrior.
Wang.
This is a game that goes on deep, deep discount very often. So this is one that I could highly recommend as well because it is a lot of fun. It is a single player focused first person shooter with a bit of nods to the old style of FPS where you're going around the level and having a lot of crossing paths that you or crossing across bridges that, over areas that you crossed before. Unfortunately, it doesn't have the huge sprawling levels. It's very linear, but it is a lot of fun. Does melee combat really well and has a lot of really good humor. I will say the humor is a lot more vulgar because, well, let's put it this way. The main the protagonist, his name is Lo Wang. And yes, he is very aware of his name and owns it. And the opening sequence is him scream singing along with "I've Got the Touch." That just sets the entire tone of the game. And I will say that it does have a great bromance with another character that pops up from time to time during your story. And it's has a lot deeper story than I was really expecting when I was going into it. It's a lot of fun, though. And while I was originally playing it, they actually did a full update to bring it up to DX11 standards. So it also performs really, really well. Trying to think of anything else major to really talk about. It's a lot of weapons, a lot of choices with your weapons, upgrades. You could just go in and start hacking away on most enemies. There are some major bosses that you really have to use your guns with, but it's more the exception than the rule. Very satisfying melee combat, though. I will say that probably a downside is that the lines do get repetitive, but that's more of just. Yeah, that's more of really any character that talks a lot. And also a lot of neat Easter eggs, going into a level and finding behind a waterfall a part of the level that looks like the 1990s version of Shadow Warrior. Doom did something similar to it. Where you go in and it's all low poly and low texture resolution. It does that.
Nice.
And typically, Shadow Warrior drops down into the $3 range. It is very, very worth it. Unless you can't stand, rather dirty humor.
Oh, I love dirty humor.
I mean, let's put it this way. If you can't stand dirty humor, what the fuck are you doing listening to this podcast?
Fair play. All right. Well, my second game, the one that I want the second most, is one that will probably surprise you. It is an isometric CRPG by the name of Tyranny. What sells me so much on this game is the story premise. You're in a world where the bad guys won, and you are one of the overlords, the new evil overlord. You're one of his like top generals or commanders at the beginning of the story. And I just love the concept of getting to role play an actual bad guy in an RPG.
Yeah, typically when you play a bad guy, you're, you know, the Diet Coke of evil.
Yeah, but this time...
I remember in Overlord, you were playing the bad guy, but you know, you were still helping out people. It felt like you were bad in just name only, really.
Yeah.
Well, that's before, you know, up to the point that I was able to play it, because I very quickly started getting motion sick just from how they handled the camera and was able to play too long of Overlord.
Yeah. But no, this time you are full on the bad guy. Everything that I've heard about the game, I've tried to avoid a lot of knowledge about the game outside of the initial, like, oh, wow, that actually sounds like it might be up my alley. But, you know, you get to choose kind of the different ways you want to be a bad guy. But, I mean, they very much allow you to torture people and murder and all kinds of stuff that, you know, in other games would be like, no, you can't do that. That's not good. So I really want to actually role play a certain type of bad guy. And so I'm looking forward to this game. The only problem is that it came out this month. So I don't see it getting a big discount in this sale. Maybe not even the Christmas sale. But
yeah, that's why I didn't want to do the recommend or my wants list in general, is that I'm not going to see a lot of discounts.
Yeah, that was kind of why I picked 4 instead of 3. Because the other games on my list are already either inexpensive or old enough to receive, you know, a decent enough discount. But Tyranny came out like 2 weeks ago. So. But I'm looking forward to it. I'll get it eventually.
Okay, so going from the depths of evil to something nice and wholesome with Stardew Valley. We mentioned Stardew Valley earlier during the Golden Joysticks. It's essentially Harvest Moon Plus. It's Harvest Moon done in the modern gaming with a lot more stuff to do and a lot more care. Now, it had recently saw a rather large update, which added a lot to the end game and also added the ability to change your farm, your starting farm. So you could set it so that if you want to be a fisherman instead of a farmer, you could have a more a farm that focuses on fishing, that has a lot of water on your farm to go fishing into. So they've definitely listened to the community. Well, I should say they. It's he. It's a single developer with a few outsourced stuff, but yeah, mostly just single developer. And it's really something to look into if you want something just chillax, you know, fire it up, play a few days of. Because it's accelerated time, you know, go from dawn till midnight and just go farming, really. Not really any complaints on it. It's a bit older now, so I'm assuming that there will be a bit of a discount, but I'm not expecting a huge discount still. But I think it is well worth it, and it's also one of the few games I bought at full price recently.
Yeah. Okay. Well, my third game that I really want is Virginia. Virginia came out a couple of months ago, and it is a...
I thought that's been a state for a while.
Fair play. There are some things you can do with it, but it's more of a walking simulator, more of an experience type game. But it has a lot of stuff that really speaks to me as a psychologist. Because you experience, or you're playing a black FBI officer, a black female FBI officer in like the late 80s or the early 90s, when women were still, in particular, women of color, were still at an incredibly disadvantaged place in society. And that's not to say that they're no longer disadvantaged or whatever. We made strides, but it was worse then, basically, is what I'm trying to say. And so the perspective of the story, plus doing a murder investigation, plus kind of the psychological and the cultural aspects that go into it, plus the art style, which I think is pretty nifty, makes this a game that really stands out to me. And I've been wanting to play it. I mean, even before it released, I knew about it. I wanted to play it. But again, you know, just a lot of games, not enough time to get to them. And I knew it would go on sale. I mean, it's not super expensive. It's only like 10 bucks. But I knew it would go on sale for probably, you know, 20, 25% off. And that's enough for me for this game, given its price and how much I want it. So that's my third game.
Okay, my fourth game is one that I'm a little leery of just because of the history of the developer, but hopefully they've learned their fucking lesson and or start going to put time bombs in their game. It's Spin Tires. Spin Tires is an off-road logging simulator where you're trying to get essentially from point A to get to point B to get logs and then point C to drop them off. Very simple in explanation, but is very difficult to do in practice.
Indeed.
And it's actually a lot more fun than it sounds like. A lot of off-roading, a lot of dirt roads, and a lot to explore, actually. And it's not an ugly game.
No, and that's even, and that's just with the base game. This game has got a huge amount of workshop support. And
yeah, unfortunately, that's mostly just vehicles right now. There are some maps on the web, but you have to go digging for them.
Yeah, but there are a lot of different vehicles, you know, stuff from like modern day, you know, monster trucks or real vehicles like, you know, Fords and things like that that have been set up for off-roading. You can also get like horses, which are a little bit weird in the way that they work, but, you know, they work.
Get yeah, trackers. And this is falling more on the line of simulation. It does an amazing job with not only how the vehicles handle, but also how the ground deforms. On one of the maps, for example, you go through essentially a lake that has a underwater road that has been pushed up. But as you go back and forth on it, that road will eventually erode away, and you're going to be in trouble if you keep using that. You have to either just do a few trips on it or find an alternate path.
Yeah.
And there's really no other game that's done land information in mud just like Spin Tires has. The tech is just amazing.
Yeah. And different vehicles do different things to the environment. The bigger and heavier they are, the more damage they do to the environment and the more difficult they are to get around generally. Well, the small light vehicles don't do much in way of damaging the environment, and they can kind of
just glide over the mud. But if you go into deep water, you're screwed,
right? Because they're, you know, they're small and they'll submerge, so
or get carried away in the current.
Yep, that has happened to me more than once. Oh,
yeah. And my asterisk with this is that the developer did have a time bomb in their code that left the game unplayable for about a week. So if they keep doing that, you know, it's going to go off my recommendations permanently.
Yeah.
But it's also a lot of fun to play with friends. It has a multiplayer, but unfortunately you can't save. So it's, you have to do the entire map in one go, and that's a couple hours.
Yeah.
You probably rush it down to about 45 minutes, but that is knowing exactly what you're doing and how to get around the map.
And having a group of people that know what they're doing too.
Yeah, the best, and not just going to burst from the forest and give you 7 liters of fuel and drive off.
Yeah, drive off into a lake, Kyle. The best we've been able to do was like an hour. And we were playing with two of us knew what to do and two of us didn't. And we managed to get it done in an hour. So, but it was one of the easier maps as well. So, but yeah, great game. Love it. Talked about it a ton on here. Both of us have. Okay. Well, my fourth and final game is one that everyone's going to go, of course. It's Major Minor.
Yeah, remember, I make fun of you for the game, not the genre.
Yeah. But Major Minor is a visual novel that has RPG, puzzle solving, and a mystery, like solving a mystery, which is, I guess, is puzzle solving. But anyways, it's all of those things. But all of the cast or all of the characters are sexy anthropomorphic animals. So you've got literal foxy ladies. And of course, the goal is to romance as many of them as possible, if you're me. This is
Wow.
like, this is definitely a game that I want to buy, but out of the games that I've listed, it's at the bottom. So there are several games I'll purchase ahead of this, unless it's got like a great discount, because it's only a couple of months old. So I'm not expecting huge discount, but it's also only $20 if I bought it right now. So I'm
Yeah,
pumped.
only.
I'm pumped. I mean, everyone knows I have a love for visual novels, and lots of
You have a
things.
love for bad visual novels.
Yeah, they're my guilty pleasure. Although I'm gonna stop using the phrase guilty pleasure, because I don't think there's any shame in liking them. That's just a phrase that I've used, but someone pointed out to me the other day that they were like, "Well, I get what you mean, but you know that kind of denotes shame, and you're not ashamed of of what you're doing, are you?" And I'm like, "Hell no."
Joe doesn't know the word, or the meaning of the word shame.
Nope. So these are just a pleasure of mine, no longer a guilty pleasure. And I know there's some of you out there who agree with me. You've told me so. I'm not gonna name any names. I'm not gonna call anybody out in case you do have shame.
Out, people.
But
Like I said, I don't. I like visual novels. It's just, yeah, some of them that you like, you're a little weird.
yeah. I almost put like the Sakura series on here, 'cause I mean they've added like four new Sakura games this year. But that's just kind of like, I pick those up when they're like $2, you know, like 3 years after they release.
Okay, so shall we move on to my last one?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so if you were disappointed in the summer for the crappy Ghostbusters, well, I shouldn't say crappy, it just the marketing material looked terrible and I never really paid attention to it. Or the absolutely abysmal game, and I could safely say that one. How about Ghostbusters 3 instead? Or Ghostbusters the video game, which is essentially the script for what would have been Ghostbusters 3. And yes, it has the original cast as well, and you play as a fifth Ghostbuster that is nameless by design. It's actually an interesting way of how they get away with the nameless, pretty much silent protagonist. Is that Venkman says, no names, we don't want to get attached. You remember what happened to the last one. And the humor is pretty much on point. I will say that Bill Murray's performance is probably the weakest out of the cast, just because he's Bill Murray and yeah, he's aloof. Showed up for a day, did as much voice work as he wanted to, and they could never contact him again. So they had to reuse some of his lines and rework some of the cutscenes to, like I said, that Bill Murray actually was speaking in some of them.
Man, Bill Murray, what a character.
Yeah. Yeah, Bill Murray, it's Bill Murray. That's the only way that you could really describe him. But,
Yeah.
the rest of the cast is pretty much on point. Only problem I really have with the game is that, well, for one, it uses a lot of PhysX. So if you're on AMD hardware, you will see some frame drops, particularly during a couple of the boss fights, just because of some of the particle effects that's going on. And also, it uses a lot of physics in some of in one of the boss fights that I had particular trouble with just because of how the fight was handled. But that was one boss fight out of a entire series. So, it's pretty well done overall. It's a third person shooter. Technically, you are still fighting ghosts, and it also has. Not just the original proton wand, but it has, if I recall correctly, four different essentially attachments to do different things that gets unlocked throughout the course of the story. And this game also goes on heavy discount, and it starts off at $10 as well. So if you are even interested in Ghostbusters and want the third story, it is definitely worth it. It has a lot of just little Easter eggs and bonuses. The Portrait of Gozer is in the Ghostbusters headquarters, for example. And just, yeah, the dancing toaster from Ghostbusters 2. Yeah, just all sorts of little nods to the older stories.
Right. I watched your Ghostbusters series. I watched your Ghostbusters series on YouTube, and it was great. There, I got the words out.
The series or the game?
Yes. Both were excellent.
Yeah, it's actually my most popular series. But mostly because I got a huge jump from the Ghostbusters mania that was happening during the summer. And it boosted my search rankings on it.
Yeah. Right place, right time.
Well, I knew that Ghostbusters was going to be big, and I wanted to go back and, you know, play the good Ghostbusters after, you know, seeing some of the stuff that was going on with the newer Ghostbusters. You know, just, do you really want to get me started? I'm not a huge Ghostbusters fan, nope. But what they did to that game, or to that movie, oh.
Nope, we're running out of time. I have to go to bed at some point.
We're only at the 3-hour mark.
Yeah, only at the 3-hour mark. All right, so those are all the games that we picked this week, which means that it's time to move on to the final section.
And you can also hopefully catch them at the curator that's at our Steam group that we'll eventually update. It's just one of those things that, that's a lot of work, and it's at steamcommunity.com/group/VGL podcast.
Yep.
And the curator is a separate follow, by the way.
Yep.
We'll eventually get to it and just do a massive dump on it.
Big dump. Huge number two.
Yeah. No Man's Sky size, you know?
Yeah. All right. So here's the part of the show where I get to go first telling you about what's going on the channel for this week. And the answer to that question is I have no idea. It's Thanksgiving. I have it prepared because of the wackiness of my week with having to cram all my clients into the first 3 days of the week. That's made it difficult to do any real video work.
Or just send everyone over to my channel.
Then Thanksgiving's Thursday, and I'm definitely taking the day off. And then Friday and Saturday are basically project days. I've got a whole list of projects to do on Friday for, like, housework, and we're doing a little bit of remodeling, and we're going to do some repainting and fix some stuff up, and we're getting some new furniture that's all assembly required, of course, so that, and we're making some significant changes to, like, some of our, like, our closets and things like that, writing some shelves, and just a whole bunch of house stuff. That's one day, and then the other day is Christmas decorating. So,
well, at least you wait till after Thanksgiving.
Yeah. So, we're going tomorrow.
In other words, you're going to be tired as hell for Portal.
Yeah.
Assuming that you show up.
Yeah. We're going tomorrow, actually, which Wednesday. So 2 days ago, if you're listening to this on Friday, if you're not, it was sometime in the past. We're actually going to get a live Christmas tree, and we're just going to kind of stick it in the corner.
And then kill it yourself.
Yeah. I've chopped down a few trees in my time. I've used a chainsaw before.
Yeah, it's more fun when they scream.
I grew up on a farm, so I've done lots of things. If the apocalypse ever happens, I would be okay. I've got the psychological skills to hopefully keep me and my party alive. And then I also have survival skills because I've grown crops. I have raised and slaughtered animals. And I know how to operate a wide variety of tools and machines.
Yeah, and then when you die, you'll be able to feed them for quite a while because you're fat.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I'll be able to stay alive for a while because I'm pretty fat. So, you know.
And you also have the long hair, so you'll be able to stay warm.
Absolutely. Keep my head warm. But all of that to say, I don't know. I'm going to try and plan some work time in there to edit and render some videos and post some stuff.
Just render out Portal 2, I guess.
Yeah, but I'm not going to make any promises. I'm just going to do the best I can. It'll be a miracle that I get the podcast edited tomorrow. It might not get done until Thursday. I might actually have to do that on Thursday instead of taking the day off to cram my face full of turkey and
be on your turkey coma.
Yeah, turkey and green bean casserole and pumpkin ale.
You're making me hungry.
Me too. Let's hurry up and wrap this up so we can get a snack and I can go to bed. So you can find me on the YouTubes if you're not on my YouTube channel by searching for Gaming Psychologist. If you want to follow me on Twitter, where I tweet about all kinds of random things, who knows what's going on there? It's just whatever I'm in the mood to talk about. You can do so over at JMA4707 on Twitter. If you want to watch me stream games, which normally is on Wednesdays and Fridays, but
Not this week.
going into the holidays, who knows? But you can do that over at twitch.tv/JArthur4707. And if you want to be my friend on Steam, I got another new friend or two this week. You can do so by looking me up and adding me on Steam. My username is JArthur4707.
And if you wish to let them know exactly what episode of the podcast you're coming from, the password this week is Pyrite.
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 Nice. And every once.
Well, I thought about fool's gold, but no, let's go a technical term.
Absolutely. Every once in a while, I do like to remind people that I am a therapist, and I love to take care of people
And get those Steam cards.
and get those Steam cards. But the podcast community is kind of a larger extension of my kind of my friend group, my family group, and maybe it's unhealthy as a content creator for me to think of all of you as my family, but hey, you know what? I care for you, so if you ever need to talk
Yeah,
about.
go get King. I'm going to have Uncle Rage teach him some interesting
Oh
words.
boy. That's what his grandfather is here for. But seriously though, if you ever need to talk about anything that's going on in your life, you need someone that, is impartial, and is trained in this sort of thing, feel free to hit me up. I had someone this week contact me and talk to me about something that's going on in their lives. And no names, no nothing like that, but it just reminded me I hadn't made that statement in a while. So seriously, anything that's going on, trust me, I've seen and heard it all. And I just would love to help you if you don't have anywhere else to turn or would like to know where to go.
Okay, I have a confession. I have Groove. He's in a crate right now with 15 pounds of uranium. And I have a shipping label, but I don't have the postage.
Well, let me give you, how much does it cost to ship uranium? It's pretty heavy. Let me just give you a
Well,
company card.
right now I'm kind of starving Groove to try to get the postage down.
Nice. So where can they, what's going on for you and your channel this week, and where can they find you at Rage?
Well, in contrast to your channel, mine's operating normally. I had a reset on RimWorld this week, and it's not going to last that long. Things went poorly in that series, which means another reset.
Right.
Because that's really what happens with RimWorld, is it just gets reset, and we try again. And if you wish to join that name list, I rename my colonist after people I know or people that I may want to see harm done to. You could you could tweet me over at Gaming with CR, and I will add you to my name list. I can't promise a meaningful death, but it will be interesting. Let's just put it this way: I have a person. Well, Katie has shown up, Jared's wife, and she kind of had an infected toe that she wasn't going to make it, so I had to amputate.
In real life, she's broken all 10 of her toes.
Well, she had an infection, and it was either amputate or, her die. And it sounds like I made the right decision considering the threat she made towards me.
Yeah, I'm glad that you kept my wife alive. I appreciate that.
Yeah, which. Oh, and by the way, at one point, in well, th this is actually the new series that's going to start next week. And actually, I think this is going to be 2 weeks pa past, or in the second week of the new series. Her ex-lover shows up in one of the raids, and I kind of kill him.
Excellent. I never liked that guy anyways.
Yeah, and Katie is by far not the most mangled. There's another guy in the fort that, well, let's say we had a melee squad showed up that I had kind of ended two series already, so I went a little nuts, and it was more, if I'm going to hell, I'm going to take you with me, and he dropped a grenade at his feet.
Nice.
And he lost an arm in that little adventure. Killed the guy, though.
Whatever works.
But yeah, beyond that, Warhammer 40K Space Marine is still ongoing, and I'm very tempted to change my plans because of something that's coming up for the Sunday sampler, which, Jared, no spoilers.
Nothing. No spoilers.
And, of course, Portal 2 is still ongoing. We're still doing the co-op, and hopefully we'll be continuing that next week. We have no backup material for that, so it's we're working without a net, and we're working on workshop content, and assuming that we still want to do Portal 2.
Yep. And there was a little tease. I'm not going to actually give anything away, but there's a fifth game that I'm looking at, but it's going to be something that we're going to maybe do together.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, assuming that you like it.
I think I will, based on what you've told me about it and some stuff I looked up, but. Gonna.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. And it's also going to, well, this may be giving it away a little bit, just if someone knows you and what I'm about to say, but. It'll be a series that will be very, 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 very ongoing. And that's even including, you know, going longer episodes, which, you know, haven't even decided on that one yet. But yeah, that's all the series. Podcast, of course, shows up Fridays at noon. And of course, the Sunday sampler, which for once, I pretty much know what's going on. There's plans right now is going to be a double header because the game I really, really want to do has an embargo for 8 a.m. Monday, which happens to be not Sunday. So I'm going to try to do a second Sunday sampler and then get the game that's embargoed out Monday morning, the second the embargo lifts. Because the hour I've spent with it so far has been fucking awesome. yes, it's rare that you hear me this excited about a game. But
it looks really good. Not, you know, not giving anything away, but it looks awesome.
Yeah, and you're going to have to check it out Monday morning to see what it is. And you could do that over at Gaming with Caffeine Rage, or you could follow me on Twitter and you'll see me tweet out about it on Monday morning or with my other stuff. Yeah, mostly been pretty random so far in the last week or so. And that's over at Gaming with CR and also Crash Jared's Twitch feeds. But yeah, that's his stuff and not mine.
Indeed.
Okay, so one last thanks to the Internet Archive.
Well, I mean, I guess technically we should thank him for a couple more weeks because we're going to do overlap. But yeah, Internet Archive is on the way out.
The cheeky little monkeys are going to be upset until they figure out how to get the Podbean feed.
Yeah.
Which, who knows? Knowing Kyle, he'll be sitting there figuring this out.
Yeah, he'll figure it out. He'll crack the password or something. And then just go in there and listen.
Kyle will be sitting there just typing away. He's like, okay, is this the file name? No, that's not the file name. Is this the file name? No, that's not the file name. But a big thanks to the Internet Archive for unknowingly supporting this absolute nonsense. Once again, if you wish to contact us with your absolute nonsense, you can do so by just emailing us at vglpodcast@gmail.com or tweeting us at vglpodcast on Twitter. If you wish to support this absolute nonsense, you can do so on our Patreon feed, patreon.com/vglpodcast. And to see the show notes for this absolute nonsense... it's over at videogamelogicpodcast.blogspot.com, at least for the time being. And are you going to fill in the other one because you didn't list it here?
I copy-pasted it in.
Don't see it in the outro checklist.
Weird. Then maybe I guess I just put it in the wrong place. Whatever. You can also go to vglpodcast.podbean.com to see our new feed and... Once we get it designed, it'll be basically our new webpage. It follows kind of a WordPress.
In other words, you're going to be putting me to work.
Yeah. You're going to have another new job, Rage.
Goody. Just wondering, is the iTunes and Google Play going to be updated?
It will be updated.
So if you're listening there, you'll not have to do really anything.
At least I think it will be updated. I think that I can just transfer them over.
Well, I guess we'll be finding that one out.
Yeah.
And if you're on iTunes, how about throwing us a review? That's going to be fun. We've never mentioned that before.
Yeah. I think we mentioned it a long time ago when we haven't talked about leaving us a review ever.
Yeah, leave us a review somewhere. Send some people our way. Think of it as a Christmas gift.
Yeah.
Or a birthday present because, you know, VGL does have a Christmas birthday, and those suck. Our intro and outro music is On the Ground by Kevin McLeod. You can find his work in Computech.com. And
as always, as his lovely music starts to roll across my voice, bye-bye now.
See you next time.
Bye. He just waved. I actually, like, physically waved. I've never done that before. Goodbye, children.
Do you realize this is audio, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it is. That's just how much I care. I waved.